of blue heaven, college hoops aristocracy, the home of Michael Jordan and Dean Smith. But it's a new wave of heels ready to make their own footprint on the ACC and the nation. College game day in an hour from right here in Chapel Hill. Sports Center rolling right now. Place that boasts a ton of great players. Nobody will wear number 23 here at North Carolina again. One of six numbers to be retired. Jordan won every major player of the year award there was. 1982, one of the criteria that will get your number retired at North Carolina. In his three seasons, he played 101 games in the Carolina blue and white. They held him under 20, though, averaged 17 points and 5 over his career here at North Carolina. Last season, another freshman burst onto the scene in North Carolina, Psycho T, Tyler Hansbrough. You know what? This guy's work ethic is legendary. Jay Billis tells us yesterday how he races his game by getting low.
I've been fortunate to play against and watch a lot of great players, and Tyler Hansbrough is the best I've ever seen at relentlessly pursuing the ball. I mean, you really believe that every ball should be yours. Where does that come from?
I think it's come from just being competitive in the backyard. You know, Gary has put me with in high school and in college, and it's just something that I possess.
And you're not a selfish player on the offensive end, but you're always calling for the ball, which opens things up for your teammates. And you do a great job of getting lower than the defense. Is that something you consciously think of?
Yeah, I think, you know, it is something that I work on and practice a lot. I feel the lower I am, the stronger I can be, and, you know, it allows me to get quicker moves off.
And you're always trying to keep contact with the defense so you can control that defense. Well, let's get a block-to-block screen, Tyler. You show me exactly how you do this
okay. And
how low you want to get. So, Wes Miller, you're going to set the screen. I'm going to get over the top, and all of a sudden you're lower, and there's not a whole lot I can do about it. Now, when you're trying to get low post, why do you always want to keep contact with your man? Defense.
Well, that's where you know where they are. And, you know, if you lose contact with them, then you don't know where they are. You don't know where you can make your move. Or, you know, if you feel them on this side, then you can go this way. If they're on this side, then you can go the other way.
And at times, you're really good at finishing plays. That's one thing you've always done extraordinarily well, is when somebody hits you, you can still finish the play. Do you concentrate on that as well?
Yeah, I think it is something I concentrate on. But also, I've done a lot in the weight room with our strength coach, and he's really helped me prepare to do that on the court.
Well, that's where you got the nickname Psycho T, but I just want everybody to know, first guy that hadn't dunked on me in one of these things.
Well, that doesn't mean that you don't get dunked on sometime. Maybe the old Carmichael Auditorium. Bill is trying to stop. Inside. Jay again arrowed. Go help side, Jay. You got to be quicker.
Take the charge. Take the charge.
Don't lose sight of the help side, Jay.
Wow.
Head on a swivel. That was an and one.
Oh, this is horrible.
Watch him
take the charge. He's getting ready to take the ball out of bounds. That's what he's doing. He knows if he steps back and gets the ball out of bounds, throw it in play faster. Good job.
Wow.
Really good for the ego.
You know what? We know that he's a lawyer, always a step ahead of the game. He's ready to take the ball out of bounds because who's going to stop Jordan, right?
It was the only time I got to touch it. I might have.
That's a different issue for a different show. Still to come on college. North Carolina would like nothing more than to add a fifth national championship piece of hardware to its trophy case. Roy Williams, we're going to tell you why Roy Williams has done something to start his career that no other coach has. He's pretty popular around here. The head coach of the Tar Heels will be joining us next.
Thank you. Welcome back to College Game Day, driven by State Farm.
Back back in Chapel Hill. Tonight, North Carolina is going to take on Georgia Tech. Tar Heels going for their 1900th victory in program history. And Roy Williams, in his first 20 seasons as a head coach, 509 victories. But there's an asterisk beside this. More than any other Division I head coach, Williams has not yet coached in his 20th season, his 19th campaign, and now is ahead of everybody in college basketball history. Some pretty good numbers for the head Tar Heel, Roy Williams, who joins us now.
Well, Reese, it means I've had a lot of good players, a lot of great assistant coaches, and had a lot of support like we do behind us.
A ton of support here. Roy, your team last week, obviously this is a team that is being looked at by many as a national championship contender, didn't play the way you wanted them to, and the players sort of get horror in their eyes when they talk about a couple of days of practice prior to the Clemson game. What did you want to accomplish in those practices?
Well, we really just brought them in and brought some lawn chairs in, and we sat down beside of them and gave them some grapes and really...
Don't lie, coach!
Hey, Wes Miller told me he's been around here too long. He knew what was coming after the Virginia Tech.
You know, we didn't play well. We weren't focused. We didn't have the intensity. And for the most part, every team that I've been involved with has really played extremely hard. And that game, we didn't play very hard.
Now, how did it manifest itself? The stuff that you wanted to emphasize in practice, how did it show itself?
Well, I think we still made some mistakes, but we competed in every possession. We ran as hard as we could run. We defended as hard as we could. We made some mistakes, but I can live with mistakes as long as you're giving me everything you have.
You know, we go back to when you had Sean May. It took them 2 years under you to get focused, and you end up winning a national championship. All right, now we got Tyler Hansbrough playing his second year with you in this group of guys. How close is this team to that team that won the national title?
You know, Digger, there's so many things that can happen between now and then, as you know, from being involved in it. But this team, I think, if we'll keep progressing, has a chance. And that's all I always ask, give us a chance. And then if we get on a great roll for six games, you know, then it's a fun, fun time. We've got to get better defensively. And that was the one thing that team down the stretch never got credit for, because we did guard people.
Coach, when you think back to what you learned from Coach Smith, Dean Smith, what is it above all else that you implement every day with your team and you use that he taught you?
Well, I learned so much, Jay. I mean, 90% of everything I do is from Coach Smith, and then the rest from Coach Knight and a few others, because I'm one of those guys, I'm not innovative. I'm a stealer. I copy things. But I think the biggest thing is trying to build confidence with your kids as long as they give you the effort and the concentration. They give me the effort and concentration, I'm going to try to help them build confidence.
Hey, Coach, how has recruiting changed over the last 19 years? I remember I had to beg you to come to North Carolina.
I went in his home.
Please, can I come?
I like the dessert that they fixed for me, too. That was good.
What is chocolate pudding?
Only the good guys get chocolate pudding. But, you know, it's changed so much because imagine 20 years ago with the club that we have right now with 11 freshmen and sophomores, you would think we're going to be so stable and the next couple of years are really going to be so much fun. Nowadays, you don't know how long everybody's going to be around.
Well, it manifested itself after you won the national championship a couple of years ago. You're back out on the road recruiting immediately. When did you take a moment to stop and realize and celebrate that national championship?
You know, people don't believe this, but September 19th, we won it in April, but September 19th, we presented the rings to the players at halftime of the football game. And at first, I was just going to have the players down there, and I said, no, the staff, we're going down too. And that's the first time they're playing the video up on the screen and giving the rings to the guys. I get cold chills right now. That's the first time that we really had some satisfaction.
So what's the thought of the day? I know you have one every day.
I told them about it. Offensive boards, defensive balance.
Persistence prevails when all else fails is one. But, you know, the one that I do try to live by is be led by your dreams, not pushed by your problems. And that's big for us all the time.
And I think the other thought you had, you told me that you have a little something that you want to present here. Like a peace offering, so to speak, perhaps.
Most Carolina. Give the boy any chocolate pudding, but we'll pass some chocolate pudding down to the boy. Just be careful. Don't spill it on him, Jay. Be careful. Don't spill it.
Very offensive tie. Finally, Jay gets some pudding. Hey, Roy, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Best of luck. Congratulations.
You guys are fantastic for college basketball. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be here. Roy Williams, nobody has won more games in his first 19 seasons than the Tar Heel head coach. And he's awfully popular in these parts, and he hopes that he can get North Carolina. The pot keeps growing. $13,000 will now will go. It is up for grabs. $10,000 should go into the general scholarship fund if this shot can be hit by Alex Bloom, a freshman from Little Rock, Arkansas. Presenting the ball is April Schaefer, a North Carolina point guard, 1978 to 1981. $3,000 for Alex. $10,000 into the general scholarship fund if you can make the shot. Alex, release, rotation, fingertip control, and follow through. Let's go.
Follow through. Balling. Here we go.
Give him the ball. Let's go. Let him shoot. He's ready, April. April, give it up. April didn't like the pass when she played either. She just wanted to shoot all the time. Alex.
Oh, crap.
Somebody's a shooter.
Let's go. Love you, Mom. Love you, Dad. Love you, Tim.
That's the whole thing. We needed a guy to dress. Show a little leg. Get $3,000. $10,000 to the General Scholarship Fund at the University of North Carolina. Courtesy of State Farm. And if Roy Williams needs a late three tonight, I know a freshman who can hit it. How about this form, Hubert?
Great form. Look at that. Unbelievable.
A little Larry Bird action at the end. Raised index finger.
Wow.
I don't know about that.
Wow.
How about Alex walking up and saying, where's my money?
It. Thank you very much.
Wow.
Thanks for the opportunity. I appreciate it. Thanks for the patience. That's huge. Appreciate it.
Alex Bloom, the freshman from Little Rock, has certainly set this place on its ear. We'll make plenty of picks if we can recover when we come back. On opponent's home floor, this is not an easy place to turn it around. Yellow Jackets and Tar Heels.
Well, I think the Tar Heels are going to win. Tyler Hansbrough had 40 points, 10 rebounds in that game. Now he has Brandon Wright, but this is a team that is on a mission.
I look at what? North Carolina and Georgia Tech. Georgia Tech, even when they beat Duke, they had over 20 turnovers. Turnovers will bother them here tonight, and I don't know how they're going to stop Tyler Hansbrough and Brandon Wright in the paint. I'm going with North Carolina.
Georgia Tech has not won a true road game in an ACC contest. They're giving up 47% shooting from the field here at North Carolina. That's not going to work. I think the Tar Heels beat Georgia Tech tonight.
All right. Duke boy getting a cheer from the great North Carolina crowd.
They gave me pudding.
They've turned you a kinder, gentler Jay Billis now. All it took was a little cup of pudding from Roy Williams. Tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, we'll be right here on the floor of the Dean Smith Center to get you ready for North Carolina and Georgia Tech in high definition. But it's not going to get better than Alex Bloom winning $3,000 from State Farm and $10,000 into the scholarship fund at North Carolina, courtesy of Alex Bloom. We're done, at least until tonight. Louisville and DePaul's coming up next. Way to shoot it, Alex.
Nothing embodies the passion.
They walk into this house that carries so much tradition. A fabulous freshman that leads Carolina on the inside and a senior who can stroke it from the outside. Rayshon Terry and his mate will have a little bit of their hands full with Rayshon Dickey, who's made a whole bunch of shots for Georgia Tech. And the Yellow Jackets on super freshman. Georgia Tech and North Carolina coming up from the Dean Dome. We're ready for a house party.
Yeah.
Welcome to College Game Day, driven by State Farm.
Their blue heaven in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where four NCAA championship banners hang from the rafters of the Dean Dome, and Tyler Hansbrough would love to hand them another one. Psycho T went off for 40 against Georgia Tech last year. He'll see if he can get loose against the Yellow Jacket team that has vastly improved, thanks largely to a couple of scintillating freshmen, Javaris Crittenden and Thaddeus Young. North Carolina and Georgia Tech coming up from the Dean Dome. What a vantage point here. We're as close as Hubert Davis used to be when he played here.
Hey, let me right tell now. You this. Hubert, 21.4 in the last 35 years. Only one guy was better, Antoine Jameson. And I called a lot of your games, and I thank you for the beautiful compliment you gave. On, did I say it the way you said it? He told me, he wrote it out. He said, please tell him this is the house that I built.
But Vitell, I was so good, they won a national championship right after I left.
Well, let me just tell you.
That happened. You probably know Dick Vitale. You've met Hubert Davis. He's Digger Phelps. Jay Billis here. We're ready for a terrific game between North Carolina and Georgia Tech tonight. And North Carolina, one of the teams, guys, staking claim to the number one team in the land. But UCLA, hope to have a little bit of say in that before the season's over as well. The Bruins, also a team teeming with tradition, taking on Arizona. First half, Josh Schiff, who did not play last week, dribbles into the lane and finds Lorenzo Mata.
And Arizona's defense, everybody goes toward the ball. The weak side collapses and Mata wide open. That was a consistent theme all game long.
Ivan Radenovic has the ball. UCLA surrounds him, at least Daniel Dillon by himself.
I'll tell you one thing. They got a great front court, but they've lost three in a row, and that's the first time in a long time.
The Wildcats had a players-only meeting, wanted to refine their intensity, but nobody stopped ball. Darren Collison takes it all the way. Second half, check out the space between Michael Rowe and the nearest defender.
Well, they're not playing any defense. Hopefully, in that team meeting, they discuss defense. You can't leave wide open shooters like that and win.
Bruins go up by seven. Next UCLA possession. Here's Roll.
Look inside. When you see the penetration, watch who picks it up. They're playing zone. No one goes to the ball. He hits a three.
47-39. Bruins have the lead now. They're finally going to get out on Roll, and he's going to find Schiff.
Well, Josh Schiff had another terrific ball game. Remember, UCLA played without Luke Richard and Bahamute. Alfred Aboye came in at 11 rebounds, and Aaron Aflalo, 22 points. UCLA, Reese, was just tougher.
UCLA has shown a great deal of toughness without Bahamute, without Schiff last week. Mustafa Shakur tries to bring the Cavs back. Radenovic hits a mid-range jumper. He has 20, but then Collison would find Schiff and finish.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. Collison has really stepped in and played really well at the point guard slot. This club is really tenacious. Then they are in transition, and Aflalo loves the big moment.
Look at Urkel. Urkel was in the stand. TV's Urkel.
Was he playing for the Wildcats?
Jaleel White. Well, maybe they could have used him. He claims to have some game. 73-69, the Bruins win. And Lute Olson has now lost three straight Pac-10 games. First time that's happened since his first season at Arizona, 1983-84. So UCLA, number two in the land, moves on. Kansas going on the road to take on the General, Bob Knight. Bob Knight, 1-5 against the Jayhawks while at Texas Tech. Alan Boskel, Jarius Jackson. That put Tech up by a dozen.
I'll tell you one thing. They got great motion in their offense. They play tough defensively to beat this young Kansas team.
Sherrod Collins drains three, cuts the lead to nine, then Russell Robinson.
Well, Kansas played with a good sense of urgency toward the end of the game. They've got to play the whole 40 minutes that way. I thought Texas Tech took the fight to him. Kansas only shot four free throws the whole game.
Brandon Rush was left wide open. Kansas was within two. Sherrod Collins to Daryl Arthur, tied at 62. But then with just over a minute to play, Daryl Dorr misses. Zeno and Jackson.
Zeno and Jackson take this game over when it counts under pressure. Great move. Now here goes Jackson. Reads it. Goes down the middle. Scores on a three-point play.
And one. And it's not exactly vintage defense.
But no defense. Nobody helps inside. Late into the ball. And that's part of Kansas' problem. I thought Knight did a great job in transition defense, but they couldn't stop him.
Collins put up the three, no good. Arthur tried to get the put back there, and Zeno's in the open floor for the punch. Now, I want to establish a rule here. Bob Knight coaches your team. There's no need to rush the floor.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, though. That's a big-time win for Texas Tech. Bob Knight, look at him right now, fired up. All the Red Raider fans fired up.
Number five goes down. Number three on the road, Wisconsin and Illinois. Their 14-game winner, the longest in the land, but Illinois had won the last seven home games against the Badgers. As Jay likes to say, something's got to give. Michael Flowers is stealing the dunk.
Well, Wisconsin is a terrific defensive team. Their bench really stepped up in this game. 23 points off the bench.
Second half, Orlando Tucker had 17.
Tucker just takes over when they need it. He is at Sally at 17 points, and you know what they want to do on defense here.
Brian Randall would drive and one, tied it at 57. He had eight. Later with the same score, Rich McBride. See the three. See the three. 15 for him. Illinois up by three, but just over a minute to go. Cameron Taylor gets blocked, but Tucker hustling.
I'll tell you one thing. You talk about Taylor as you watch the hustle right there. Taylor's one of the most underrated guards. Tucker with the big shot. They make big plays all the time. Taylor with 20 points. He and Flowers is so underrated.
Burn a baby burn. The Wisco Inferno has ripped off 15 in a row. They get their first win at Illinois in their last eight tries. They're 4-0 on the road this season. Their only loss came at the hands of Missouri State, and that was on a neutral floor. Florida at home against Hottie Totty. Ole Miss, Billy Donovan, his team ranked number one in the land, the reigning champions. Florida up 22-13, Torian Green, Corey Brewer, and then Green finds Joakim Noah.
I'll tell you one thing, Noah really had his A game. They got the best front court in basketball with Noah, Horford, and Brewer.
52-28, but Ole Miss comes roaring back. Greg Hardy gets it blocked by Noah, who had three rejections on the day. Al Horford finds Noah inside.
Anytime you get shots like that, you are going to win ballgames. Joakim Noah, 24 points, 9 of 10 from the field, but Florida turned it over 18 times. That's what kept Ole Miss in it.
24 points for Noah, 79-70. Number one, a little bit of a comeback for Ole Miss, but Florida took care of business. Now, among these teams we just saw them. We're going to see Carolina a little bit later on, Digger. Florida, Wisconsin, Kansas, UCLA. And don't get too caught up in today's game, but who's the most vulnerable long-term?
Well, I think the worst thing that happened to Kansas is when you go back 2 weeks ago, they beat Oklahoma State at home by 30. And then all of a sudden, last week, they go out to Iowa State, getting an overtime game with it. And this past Monday, they struggled to beat Missouri at home. So they were playing with fire. Today, they got burned by Texas Tech. And I think that's the issue right now. Kansas got to regroup, show some leadership under pressure, and come up with a win because the talent is there.
I agree with you, Coach. Kansas, I think they're a most vulnerable team. They're terrific defensively, but offensively, they just don't have a go-to guy. It changes from game to game, and they don't get enough points in the paint through dribble penetration or post-up play. They had four free throw attempts today, and that's because they're shooting too many outside jump shots. Sharon Collins did that in the Missouri game, got them back in the game tonight against Texas Tech, too late for them.
And that's really the key. You know, they've got a lot of talent, Kansas. They're very good defensively, but Hubert raised it. Who do they go to when they need a basket? Wisconsin goes to Orlando Tucker. They can go to Cameron Taylor. Florida's got a whole host of guys they can go to. First and foremost, Torian Green. But with Kansas, they don't know. We don't know. Nobody knows for Kansas who they go to when they really need a tough hoop.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, Jay. I think we all knew preseason, we thought it was going to be Brandon Rush. I don't think Rush has had the All-American kind of year. And he's the guy that they have to have make their big plays. I had them against Florida. They look sensational. But to me, I agree. I think they're the most vulnerable. When you can lose to DePaul, you can lose to Oral Roberts, lose to Texas Tech, I don't think you're in the class with the clubs we're talking about right now. And I want to know something else. The RPI rates Florida number 28. Well, the VBDI is a hell of a lot better than the RPI because that is a joke. Them being number 28, that demeans the use of the RPI.
It's the non-conference schedule, though, that they played. Yeah. Not that it was awful, but some of them dragged
the numbers
down.
But it's a fair point. I mean, that RPI is ridiculous. Right. It's a general indicator of relative strength.
It's
not a general indicator of who's best. Right.
How many times do I have to tell you guys? It's
use
not a precision
BBDI.
Tool.
Use
it's a blunt
BBDI.
Instrument.
The Vitae Ball Dome Index.
So Florida's number one in the VBDI?
Well, right now I'd say they're playing number one in the nation. UCLA, I love their tenaciousness. As Jay said, they played without the big guy today. By Amute. They played without Ship in the last game. They had lost. I think when they have all their parts, defense today prevailed against Arizona. Wisconsin, certainly with Tucker making big play after big play, very dangerous. I think a tough loss for Illinois. They got seven losses now. They're 2-4 in conference play. I think they got a fight like for survival. You know who the winners today? The Vanderbilt, Michigan, and Indiana.
Yep.
They all helped their resume big time.
We'll see that a little bit later on in the show. You know, you're going to have some more input for that VBDI if you see North Carolina against Georgia Tech tonight. And the Tar Heels have been a little bit of hit and miss in their last two games. Last Saturday in Blacksburg against Virginia Tech, fell behind by 21. They rallied late, but Roy was fired up. They had some physical intense practices, and the results showed Wednesday night at Clemson. A 22-point victory, a virtual layup line against that Clemson press, 77-55. Brandon Wright hit his first seven shots in that game, hitting 65% from the field, and leads the ACC. You'll see North Carolina, Brandon Wright, Tyler Hansbrough, and the guys against Georgia Tech at 9 o'clock Eastern time. All right, Dick, you're going to call the game with Mike Patrick tonight. What are the keys to the game?
Well, I think number one, you got to certainly, when you look at North Carolina, you got to try to stop their transition game. You can't allow Wright to get such deep position on the inside. And certainly Hansbrough had 40 against them on this floor to break a Dean Dome record, which I thought you would have had. You allowed Hansbrough to have that record. I think there's so many factors. And then psychologically, guys, and I know you'll bandy this around. I talked to Paul Ewing about it tonight. He said it doesn't bother these kids because they're resilient. But don't you think losing 14 in a row on the road, you start to think about it, and it becomes a psychological problem?
There's no question. When you're not a good road team and you haven't had that success on the road, there's no question it gets into your head, and especially as you're going down the stretch of games. I do think that's going to be a factor for this young team. Georgia Tech has to get off to a good start. Otherwise, it can be a really long night for them.
Hey, guys, we're going to see five of the best diaper dandies in America. Yeah. Crittenden, Young, and then you look at Lawson, the Duke of Ellington, shooting his three, and certainly Brandon Wright.
We'll see them all. Dick's going to call the game with Mike Patrick coming up in just a little while. Always a pleasure.
Dick Vitale.
See, you know what? Digger was afraid to give you the rap this week.
Give me the rap.
Tywan Lawson, the freshman point guard. He has some serious jets, averaging over 5 assists per game. He'll lead that Tar Heel attack. Bobby Frazier still hurting a little bit. Tech in North Carolina coming up at the top of the hour. And still to come on College Game Day, Oklahoma State and Texas played a classic this week. What would the residual effect be on the Longhorns as they step out of conference? And Greg Oden, believed to be the best big man in America, best one to come into the college game in more than 20 years, some say. And we'll see Tyler Hansbrough a little bit later on tonight and take you off the court with Hansbrough, living the life.
College Game Day is driven by State Farm. Great service, great rates. It's all here. Nobody takes care of you like State Farm. And in part by Siemens. And Pontiac, the official performance machines of the NCAA.
The stately quarters of the Tar Heels, and what happens, Hubert, if you put your heels on that logo?
You're not going to do that.
Do not step on the logo.
What they put it on the floor for?
45 minutes until Georgia Tech will take their shots at putting their foot down against the heels. They haven't won in the Dean Dome since 1996. You're always so logical. This is a 92-83 victory back in 96 in overtime for the Yellow Jackets. Hey, this morning on College Game Day, if you missed it, you missed the shot of the year. Carolina freshman for 3,000. Alex Bloom. It was a $13,000 half-court shot. $10,000 went to the general scholarship fund from State Farm, and $3,000 went right into Alex's pocket. Whoever Alex's buddies are, Alex is buying tonight for everybody. West Virginia and Cincinnati. Final seconds. West Virginia up 9. Frank Young. Look, I've seen Alex Bloom, and Frank Young's no Alex Bloom.
He didn't even call bank.
43-31 Mountaineers. Jamal Warren going going inside, and this puts the game into overtime. Bearcats come all the way back. Cincinnati up by 6, and Cincinnati on the move.
Well, it was Marvin Gentry. He had a career-high 32.5 three-pointers, and Cincinnati gets their first Big East win of the year.
That was John Williamson finishing 96-83. Texas and Villanova. Curtis Sumter got kicked in the leg in the Notre Dame game and sat out. Kevin Durant, who had 37 against Oklahoma State, loose inside.
And one of his few baskets on the night, he only went 4 of 15 from the field, 1 of 8 from three. You can see that Big East logo down there. They had to take that off because guys were slipping on it. They had to call the travel on Kevin Durant, not his fault. But then they took it up right after that, and that stopped it a little bit.
Peel away the dangerous sticker. Make sure you get the footing. Just under 6 minutes to go in the second half. Nova by 11. Scotty Reynolds originally signed with Oklahoma. You would think he would have a disdain for Texas.
Well, Scotty Reynolds was the difference in the ballgame. 26 points. He had 6 assists. He also got people open for shots. A big difference maker.
Freshman DJ Augustine has 25. That cut the lead to 11. A.J. Abrams in transition. NBA range. Texas within 2. And here come the Longhorns. Under a minute to go, 6 points down. How about J.D. Lewis drawing a foul on the three-point attempt? He would hit all 3 free throws. And Kevin Durant, down 4, couldn't get it to fall.
Couldn't get it to go, but give a lot of credit to Dante Cunningham. He was in his face all game long. Cunningham had 16 points and 6 rebounds in addition to his defense on Durant.
Durant had 1 point in the second half. You see, in the last 4 games, he had averaged 34. His rebounding also off a little bit. And look, I don't want to make excuses for him because Nova did a great job. Triple overtime game this week in which he just played his guts out with 37 points against Oklahoma State.
Plus, he's a freshman. He's allowed to have an off game now and again without us getting all crazy on him.
Oh, come on, Jay. Get a little bit crazy on him. Guy's putting up 35 every night. Indiana and UConn. Kelvin Sampson and the Hoosiers really needing a signature road win. And I know that UConn's not what it has been, but it still says Connecticut on those jerseys. And DJ White is becoming a force.
Boy, did he make that move one-on-one. He ends up with 21 points and 3 rebounds. But they come back. Here come the Huskies.
Doug Wiggins, who got the start. He had 8 points, tied the game at 39 at the half. Second half, DJ White. Roderick Wilmot is also stepping up.
Wilmot had a big game. Comes in and hits them. Points they need him. 5 threes, but 23 big points for name. But watch the flash here.
Yeah, it's Mike White screens Marcus Johnson, and Wilmot is wide open. Indiana takes the lead by 1, but UConn comes right back. Stanley Robinson, the freshman from Birmingham, Alabama, 21 points on the night. UConn back on top, but Wilmot had another answer.
Yes, he did. He didn't let up at the end. I'll tell you, Connecticut was up 2, but they couldn't close the game with 2 minutes to go.
77-73, Indiana gets a solid road win. As I said, I know UConn, a lot of new players. This is a good win for the Hoosiers. How good are they, Jay?
They're a good team, not great, but they're getting better. And I think Kelvin Sampson and his staff have done a pretty good job of disguising or camouflaging some of that team's weaknesses. They've got a few guys that can't dribble, but they've got some guys that can shoot it. And DJ White is starting to get his legs under him, and he is playing better and better in the post. He's running the floor a little bit better, getting back to the DJ White of old. Is this a great team? No, but it's a solid team, and you're going to have to play well to beat them.
Yeah, I agree with you, Jay. This is a great defensive team. Offensively, they're good when they're knocking down three-point shots. They were at 50% today against UConn, and when DJ White is a factor down low in the post, he had 21 points. But let's keep it real. I mean, they were on fire today, and they only scored 77 points. So they play at Illinois next week. We'll see how good they are on the road.
Now, UConn's going to go back into Big East play, but the Huskies miss an opportunity to get a non-conference victory. What's the big problem for the Huskies right now?
I just think it's a confidence factor. When you look at what they really did well today, they got 19 points for 19 off of 19 offensive rebounds. But they don't make their free throws. And when they had that 2-point lead at the end of the game, that's when they got to learn to close the game, because they had Indiana on the ropes. They let it get away from them. But I feel this way now. They know where they stand. I think when you look at Doug Wiggins out there as the leader of that team, that really helps, because now you got something to identify your offense with. And once they start scoring points in the perimeter, then they'll have things things inside to get that balance, and that's all they need. One big win, and the confidence will kick in because they're too good a team not to.
They need one leader. Nobody's leading them. They need whether he's got the ball or not. Somebody needs to step forward and be a leader for that team.
Offensively, at least from a point production standpoint, I know that's not exactly what you're talking about. Stanley Robinson might be that guy. 21 points against Indiana, but you, once again, the common denominator on some of these teams that we're saying, quote unquote, with problems. Rayshon Dickey, averaging over 6 rebounds per game. He's a big deal for Georgia Tech tonight because inside they're going to have to deal with Tyler Hansbrough. Tech and Carolina coming up on ESPN HD at the top of the hour. And speaking of the aforementioned Mr. Hansbrough, who put 40 on the Jackets last year, will take you inside the life of a modern-day Tom Sawyer.
Welcome back to College Game Day, driven by State Farm.
Carolina Blue seats going to fill up tonight. Georgia Tech and North Carolina coming up from the Dean Dome at the top of the hour. Georgia and Alabama. Georgia jumping out quickly. Levi Stoops to three. Alabama fell behind by 15 in the first half for the third straight game. They continued to shoot it well with Sundiata Gaines.
Well, Sundiata Gaines had 22 points. Alabama went to a 2-3 zone in the second half, and it really helped slow Georgia down after that hot start.
Richard Hendricks finding Mikhail Riley inside. Riley had 17. Under a minute to go. Hurt or not, they're going to Ron Steele.
Just pulling up deep behind that high screen. Ronald Steele was outstanding over the last minute and a half.
Georgia with a chance to regain the lead in the waning seconds. Loose ball. Gaines fires it up. The turnover. Alabama gets possession late.
Ronald at six between the rings. Off a screen at five. Looking at two. Tied up. Shoots it at the buzzer. It's good! It's good! Ronald Steele out the buzzer!
Chris Stewart with the call, Jay.
Well, Georgia did not do a very good job of defending this play. There were guys open, but they left the ball. Now, you can argue all you want about whether Steele walked or moved his pivot foot, but it was not well defended by the Georgia Bulldogs.
78-76, Alabama. LSU on the road at Arkansas. First half hogged up by six. The freeze here, Tasman Mitchell following Sonny Weems. Leaves Charles Thomas open for the three. Razorbacks up by nine. Gary Irvin will fake on Big Baby and he'd take off.
Well, LSU wasn't playing any defense. They've been struggling on both ends of the floor, but Arkansas got anything they want in the paint. It was the Stephen Hill show, 8 of 10 from the field.
Hill and his bandana and all of his hair continuing to wreak havoc.
Well, LSU has really struggled guarding the pick and roll, and Stephen Hill did an outstanding job of rolling to the hoop. He missed two shots. I don't know how he missed two shots, ducking all those balls. Bad defensive play today for LSU.
Kicked it out to Weems. Arkansas crushes LSU. The SEC West team has not won a conference game on the road yet. Vanderbilt had never won in Rupp Arena until last year. Bobby Perry, the steal, he would go the other way for the dunk.
Yeah, this is one transition play they got, but they didn't have a great game because Joe Crawford didn't show up. He was 4-for-17.
One of the four. With 90 seconds to go, Dan Cage is loose.
Same situation. What happens? You get turnovers, you get points. They shoot the threes. They made 11, Vandy. Kentucky was only 6-for-22 on threes.
72-67, Vanderbilt. Two straight big wins. There is Tyler Hansbrough, averaging over 18 points per game and 8 rebounds. Hansbrough leading his team against Georgia Tech coming up a little bit later on tonight. Psycho T, as they call him, drove Georgia Tech nuts the last time the Jackets came in here. Put 40 points on them. No ACC freshman has ever scored more in a game. And Hansbrough's intensity not only made him a legendary figure already here in Chapel Hill, he might be approaching Redick status in terms of popularity elsewhere in the ACC. Andy Katz on a Tom Sawyer type guy turned hero in the Tar Heel Nation and living the life.
Look at Hansbrough muscling his way in.
He's a dicey.
He's got future star written all over him.
You were from a very small town. What was the toughest adjustment for you coming from Poplar Bluff to Chapel Hill?
I'd say being away from my family. That was really hard growing up with my brothers and my mom and dad, you know, pretty much my whole life. And just being, halfway across the country from them and getting used to without them being there for a long time. I mean, I got homesick a little bit.
You have an open day. You can spend it anywhere. Where would you want to be and what do you want to do?
Be in Poplar Bluff on a lake, my friend's lake. It'd be fishing with my friends and just us and, you know, out there pretty much just the lake and just goof around, catch fish.
How would you compare that kind of tranquility to what goes on at a high-pressure college basketball game?
It's pretty much the opposite. Everything's real tense. Everybody's screaming in your face. And it's really, you know, a lot of pressures there. The intensity, you know, in a big atmosphere, it's totally different.
If there's one kind of play in a basketball game that you love more than anything else, what is it?
One play, I'd say, where the ball's on the floor, you have like five guys, everybody's diving in there, and you have that one aggressive guy that goes in there harder after anybody else and gets the ball. That's one of my favorite plays because it really says something a lot about that guy.
What's it like playing in this building?
It's great, you know. It can get rocking. A lot of people, you know, knock it for, says it's a quieter and kind of a relaxed crowd. But since I've been here, the fans are great.
How often, if at all, do you ever find yourself looking up and seeing the national championships or the jerseys?
I would say a lot. I mean, it's hard to go a day without at least glancing at them or looking at them. And I'd say, you know, probably every day. I'm pretty sure everybody on our team glances at him.
How long do you want to play Carolina?
4 years. I love this place.
Compare Hansbrough to some other North Carolina big men in the jump between their freshman and sophomore year. Well, it's not as much of a jump for Hansbrough because there's not much room to go up after the great freshman season. Plus, he has a better supporting cast this time around. Digger Brandon Wright saying, hey, it'd be tough for anybody to score 40 on our team right now. But if you're Georgia Tech now, you know what he did to you last year. How do you stop?
Well, if I'm Georgia Tech, and I'm sure they've done that, Paul Hewitt knows, if you go back and look at tapes of how they've lost games, you've got to at least look at what Gonzaga did to North Carolina in the preseason NIT semifinal game. They really did a good job of mixing defenses. They played man-to-man, they played zone, they double-teamed Taylor Hinesbarrel, so Tyler now goes 2-for-5, 9 points. The other situation is they said beat us with the three, so they sag off. Carolina shoots 6-for-26 threes. They do 37% for the game. So the defensive pressure, mixing defenses, I think that's important. Paul Hewitt may do that tonight. The other thing, don't forget, when they lost to Virginia Tech on the road, Virginia Tech went after them full court, forcing 17 turnovers for 20 points. I think Paul Hewitt tonight, and talking to him today, I would not be surprised if he tries to do the same thing with Hansbarrel, as well as see what kind of pressure they can put on full court and half court and force them into turnover situations to carry the game.
A couple of numbers that we've mentioned about Hansbarrel, the 40-point game last year. People forget, Georgia Tech had a 20-point lead in that game, so it's not as if the Jackets were totally turned inside out, at least not in the early going by North Carolina. What's the key to the game tonight?
Well, I think for Georgia Tech, they can't single coverage Tyler Hansbarrel. They gave him 40 points, 10 rebounds, but more importantly, it was 19 free throws. So they have to get him out of the block. They have to double team, get the ball away from him. But the key is North Carolina, this is a different team. Last year, Tyler Hansbarrel was the only inside threat. Now he has help. Brandon Wright, Alex Stevenson, Deion Thompson. So it's going to be a different North Carolina team. But first, they have to do the job on Tyler Hansbarrel.
I think it's all about taking North Carolina out of transition and making them play a half-court game. North Carolina averages over 82 points per game in the ACC. They like to get out and run. They run after made field goals. They run after misses and get outlet passes, run their secondary break and get down the floor. And they run off of your turnovers. Georgia Tech turns the ball over 17 times per game, and they have turned it over 28 times in their ball game against Duke. They cannot afford to put pressure on their defense by turning the ball over and letting North Carolina get out in transition. Look what North Carolina did to Clemson. Clemson pressed them. They turned them over 22 times, and North Carolina still beat them by 22. Why? Because they gave them so many easy baskets in transition. If you press them, you better not let them throw over the top where they can get 3-on-2, 2-on-1s. That's going to be a key. Keep them out of transition, half-court game, then you got a chance.
Georgia Tech getting together and hoping to come out here and stop what has turned into a 14-game losing streak on the opponent. on its home floor, including that loss last year to North Carolina, in which the Yellow Jackets led a 20-point lead getaway. Paul Hewitt's team running onto the floor of the Dean Dome, and some of the students behind us, well, they're not exactly giving them a hospitable welcome. Brutus, the Buckeye, will see Thad Mata's team next week. College Game Day rolls to Ohio State. We'll talk about Odin in a bit, and we'll also take you inside the mind of the Georgia Tech coach.
Put some velocity on the pass. That's how you end up with 28 turnovers in a game.
This is the Siemens Trophy. It goes to the national champion. North Carolina will actually like to add a fifth NCAA title to its trophy case by the end of the season. Washington State, maybe not a national championship contender, but Tony Bennett has them ranked in the top 25 against a reeling Washington team. John Brockman stuffed by Kyle Weaver. Somebody Pontiac game changer for the day. He finds Derek Lowe.
Well, this team just seized the tempo from the very beginning. Derek Lowe had 20 points. They were doubling the post. They were blocking shots. Ivory Clark was all over the place. Great pass to Clark right here. That guy's 6'5". He plays like he's 6'9" with those arms.
And how about your guy Derek Lowe filling it up?
Derek Lowe is an outstanding player, the Hawaiian cliff diver. He's a daredevil.
I dare you to get in his face. Too late. 75-47. Washington's 1-6 in the league. And now in the last seven games, the Huskies have had a lot of road trips, but there's not much margin for error now.
Somebody in the Pac-10 office does not like Washington to send that young team on the road this often to start the season out. They shot 28% at the Palouse. You're not going to beat anybody doing that.
In the ACC, Boston College and Clemson, BC with this issue. Sean Williams kicked off the team. Oliver Purnell trying to bounce back from a thumping at the hands of North Carolina. Cliff Hammond behind the arc.
Yeah, they even tried to play some zone. But without Sean Williams, who blocks about five shots a game, they really had problems. Yes, the turnovers killed them. 24 points for Clemson off of 21 BC turnovers. And yet they even got 15 points on 12 offensive rebounds with no Williams in there to block. And that's what I'm talking about right there.
James Mays with the follow. Tigers by a dozen. Hammond drains the three. Very good stat on the block shots, Digger. Five per game. Williams averaged by himself. They only had one as a team. 74-54 the final. Duke and North Carolina State. Coach K and the Devils going for their third straight ACC win. Paul Espinel.
Well, Paul has been playing terrific since being put back in the starting lineup. He had 13 points, four assists, and he only had six turnovers in his last three games.
Duke pulling out to a big lead. Nelson McRoberts with the baptism. Duke building a huge lead. 25-14. There's McRoberts again. Another flush. Second half, John Shire gets the stroke.
Well, it was a total team effort. They had 16 assists as a team. Five guys in double figures. Great road win for the Duke Blue Devils.
McRoberts with 13 points. Duke building this 62-41 lead. They would end up winning it by 23. And the Devils have really improved their offense. They've played great defense, improved the offense the last three games.
Well, they have, and I think in large part because of Greg Paulus. He's been taking care of the basketball. He's been consistent in terms of knocking down that three-point shot. He's shooting 50% from three-point range. He's involving everybody in the play, and that's why Duke has been successful in their last three games.
Well, the Devils are moving ahead of 500 in ACC play. Georgia Tech gets North Carolina here in the Dean Dome at the top of the hour. This might get Paul Hewitt ostracized by his peers. He has a degree in journalism. What he craves is more insightful reporting, things that you learn, like when you go on the inside and have the coach wired for sound.
2-1-0 pass and cutting. Let's go. Let's go. Come on. Pair up. Let's go. I don't want to see these one-hand push passes. Follow through, elbows locked, thumbs down. Put some velocity on the pass. That's how you end up with 28 turnovers in a game. When that ball gets reversed, you can almost guarantee you're going to get back screened. So jump to the ball, go over the top of it, beat him to the block. Follow through, two hands, elbows locked, thumbs down. Let's go again. Turn and just get him like this. Just stop him right there. Just stop him, chest to chest, and now get back to yours. He's not a guy that's going to be able to change directions and make good passes, accurate passes. 12 assists, 41 turnovers. His first and second step are strong. That's why we got to give extra help. Early help. Let's go. Come on.
Help!
Good job. Not bad.
Hewitt trying to coach up his young team to be a contender in the ACC. If we all buy the idea that Carolina's the best team in the league, who's going to challenge them?
Well, to me, it's Georgia Tech. I think they have the athleticism and the length to be able to match up with North Carolina.
I'm going to go with Virginia Tech. I think their two wins over Carolina and Duke were legit, and I think the way they force you into turnovers, 37 points against those two teams by forcing turnovers, even though they lost to Florida State, I think Vitek's in there.
Nobody. I mean, Carolina can get beat in the league, clearly. People can beat them, but nobody's as good as they are, and nobody's going to challenge them for the top spot. After the league season is over, they're going to be on top.
They're building the basketball dynasty once again, coming off a national championship just a couple of years ago. What North Carolina would like to go along with the great soccer program, the great baseball program, is maybe they can add football to the mix, too. Roy Williams and Butch Davis sharing a moment here. We'll hear from the Tar Heels' new football coach when we come back.
Welcome back to College Game Day, driven by State Farm.
There's the yard Mia Hamm built. North Carolina women's soccer program has won 18 national titles. There have only been 25 NCAA championships. That is domination. Anything close to that would be good for the North Carolina football program. Aaron Andrews with the new coach of the Tar Heels, Butch Davis.
All right, Reese. Well, thank you so much. Butch Davis, been in... You had this job for 7 weeks. It's been a whirlwind. How's it going for you so far?
Well, Aaron, we're off to a great start. We're really excited. I mean, obviously the enthusiasm and passion tonight. We've got recruits in this weekend. We're putting together a great staff. And University of North Carolina is an easy sell because they've got so much academic credibility and a lot of potential.
How do you use this environment and the tradition of the basketball program to help you out football-wise?
Well, Aaron, you know, I had an opportunity to talk to Roy Williams right after I took the job, and he was so supportive, and he talked about, you know.
Apologize for that technical difficulty there in Aaron's conversation with Butch Davis. There is Tyler Hansbrough. We go on the floor getting set for the Tar Heels and the Yellow Jackets. Jay, you did a demonstration with Hansbrough in the morning edition of Game Day, talking about his intensity, his relentless pursuit of the ball. That's not something you can teach necessarily, is it?
I think it's something that's just in him. You can see it. Remember when we used to see Mike Singletary's eyes? He's got that same crazed look when he's on the floor, and I mean that in a good way. He goes after every ball, and he thinks it belongs to him. And that's a rare thing in a big guy. You have guys who rebound in their area only. He rebounds out of his area. When the ball's on the floor, he puts his body on the line, and he goes and gets it. I mean, he is just a great college basketball player in large measure because he goes after it so hard.
You know, Hansbrough was rookie of the year last year. Brandon Wright, Digger, might be it this year.
Boy, do they complement each other so well inside. And if you may think you can stop Hansbrough, you're not going to stop Brandon Wright. He can score. He knows where to go. He gets on the offensive board situation. And yes, he can get up and down the floor. This guy is the one player that I look at when you look at freshmen around the country. Yeah, I feel that this is the best player that gets on the floor that complements the other four players on that court, especially when he's playing with Tyler Hansbrough.
And from the inside, the guys outside. Hey, Wes Miller ought to warm your heart. He's a guy like you. He just wanted to be here more than
he's here. He's been absolutely fantastic. He's one of two seniors along with Rayshon Terry. I think he's done an outstanding job. He knocks down perimeter jump shots. And what that does is it allows Tyler Hansbrough, Brandon Wright, these guys to operate down low in the paint. He is also an excellent defender. He's a guy that's going to pick up full court, Javaris Crittenden, make him change some play. And I think he does an outstanding job of changing the game.
You know, Rayshon Terry's the only scholarship senior on the team because Miller gave up his scholarship so they could bring in this ballyhooed freshman class.
And Rayshon Terry is the kind of guy you need on your team if you want to be a champion because he's willing to give of himself to the team. There are a lot of guys who would have younger players come in to play these big roles, scoring, that you would say, hey, wait a minute, I'm a senior, I deserve this. But Rayshon Terry does what's best for the team, and that speaks very well of him. I think they'll go a long way because of it.
Terry is senior and part of that freshman class. Taiwan Lawson excellent, excellent quickness.
I just love his energy. I love his leadership. He's not afraid to go to the hole. And when you see how he gets down this court in transition, he can dish it, but yet he can score by making himself what? A player that can go to that basket and draw the three-point play. He's the reason why I look at them as a position to say, you know, freshman point guards making teamwork. He stepped up since Bobby Frazier's been hurt and taken over the leadership of running this offense.
I can't remember a point guard that's faster with the ball than Ty Lawson. I mean, he is just speed personified.
Another pretty good young guard, Javaris Crittenden, at 23 in a win against Florida State. He'll be tested here on the road tonight.
Well, he's a very quick point guard, and he really works well in the pick-and-roll situation when they don't throw the ball down to Rayshon Dickey. Javaris Crittenden does a nice job of getting into the middle, distributing the basketball, and also scoring. He's a tremendous point guard.
This is the key.
This is the key tonight.
Yeah, he's got to take care of business with Tyler Hansbrough and Wright.
Rayshon Dickey shot it very well. Dick Vitale and the guys will be calling the game. Dick Vitale and Mike Patrick will call the game. Top of the hour here from the Dean Dome in Chapel Hill.
College Game Day is driven by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And in part by Pontiac, the official performance machines of the NCAA. And Siemens.
Less than 7 minutes till tip-off between North Carolina and Georgia Tech. And it's coming up in a matter of moments from the Dean Dome here in Chapel Hill. Guys, let's run a little quick weave here. Who's the most impressive team of the day?
Well, for me, it's Vanderbilt. Three straight wins, fourth win over a top 25 team. Derek Byers had 23 points, and actually Vanderbilt beat Kentucky last year in Lexington.
I'm going to go with, you got it, Texas Tech over Kansas. Why? A big win for them. Getting it done inside, outside. Jerry Jackson company got it to where they needed the big points, and this puts them in a position now as they got a tough schedule coming up to have a quality win in Big 12 Conference.
I'm going to go with UCLA. Playing shorthanded, I thought they really came out strong against Arizona. Shooting 49% from the field without Luke Richard and Bob Mute. Alfred Aboya came in, got a career-high 11 rebounds. UCLA was stronger mentally and physically, and they looked like a champion against Arizona in Pauley Pavilion today.
How about the biggest disappointment?
Well, for me, it's Washington. They lost big to Washington State. This is a team that's really struggling on the road, but they have 7 games remaining at home in the Pac-10. They're going to have to pick it up quick.
I thought Kentucky losing at home to Vanderbilt, that was the shocker today. Kentucky on an 11-game winning streak, in a position to make a statement since they were unranked, but this Vanderbilt team made 11 threes, and that was the difference, and they got it done on the road.
I was disappointed, frankly, for Arizona. I thought the Wildcats were going to come out a lot stronger. In the first half against UCLA, they shot only 29%. They coughed the ball up 9 times. That led to 11 UCLA points, and it really led to their demise for the entire ballgame.
And here come the Tar Heels onto the floor of the Dean Dome, just moments away from taking on Georgia Tech in an ACC showdown. Guys, how about the Pontiac game changer tonight?
Well, for me, it's Anthony Morrow because of the loss of Lewis Flint. Their top three-point shooter, Morrow's going to be able to knock down three-point shots in conference play, 50% from three-point range.
I think for Georgia Tech, it's got to be Rayshon Dickey. The 6'10 guy is going to have his hands full with Hansbrough and Wright, but yet in the conference, he's averaging 87% in the field, shooting 20 for 23. Get him the ball. Attack inside. He's averaging 15 a game in conference play. Get it done.
I think for North Carolina, it's going to be Brandon Wright, the freshman. The lefty's got a 7'4 wingspan, averaging over 16 per game, 6.5 rebounds, and shooting 65% from the field in ACC games. This young man is an outstanding player. I think he's going to be on the finishing end of a lot of Taiwan lofts and passes.
And I know that Tyler Hansbrough is going to put up big numbers, but Rayshon Terry, 6 times this year, he's been the defensive player of the game for North Carolina. I expect his defense to get Carolina going, stifle Georgia Tech. He'll be the Pontiac game changer for Roy Williams tonight. Look, Roy comes bearing gifts. No wonder he's so popular here. Roy Williams getting set the lead, North Carolina, against Georgia Tech. And in this game, Georgia Tech is going to try to snap a 14-game losing streak on opponent's home court. Some people say trying to beat Carolina and Chapel Hills tougher than having a root canal. Well, Thaddeus Young's going to find out the difference. Aaron Andrews reporting that the Georgia Tech big man needs a root canal next week, is going to try to play tonight. How that's going to impact things, we'll see in just a few moments. Hubert, what about your Pontiac primetime pick, the Yellow Jackets and the Tar Heels?
Well, if North Carolina is going to start about defensively, if they play defense like they did against Clemson, Georgia Tech can't beat them, nobody in the country.
I think it's going to be Carolina, too. Why? I think Georgia Tech's going to have too many turnovers, and that really helps the transition game for Carolina. And then when you go to the half-court game, it's going to be Hansborough and Wright, too much inside. I think Carolina wins this one.
Yeah, I think it's going to be Carolina as well. I think it's going to be very difficult for Georgia Tech to take North Carolina out of their transition, and that's really the key. If you can limit North Carolina, keep them in a half-court game, you got a chance. I just don't think Georgia Tech in this atmosphere is going to be able to do it when they haven't had success on the road.
Boston College has taken a conference loss. North Carolina has just won. The Tar Heels can stay even in the loss column if they can take care of business here at the Dean Dome tonight. Tech hoping to make a statement. It ought to be a great one here from the Dean Dome tonight. Georgia Tech in North Carolina. Mike Patrick's going to have the call for us. Mike.
Thank you very much. And, of course, North Carolina's basketball program may be the most storied of all in college basketball, with its light blue line of All-Americans and the championship banners hanging from the rafter in the Dean Dome. For the spirited Tar Heel fans, it's an irreplaceable part of who they are. Many say that following the team is one of the most valuable and enduring attachments of their very lives. Tonight, their nemesis is Georgia Tech. Dickie V joins me shortly on ESPN Saturday Primetime next.
Hey, Dick, get over here. We got work to do.
It's another sellout crowd at the Dean Dome, 21,750 to watch a big ACC early season matchup, part of Saturday primetime, presented by DirecTV as part of Student Spirit Week. It's Georgia Tech at 13-4 against the fourth-ranked team in the country, North Carolina at 16-2. And with Boston College lost today, there are three teams at the top of the ACC with only a single defeat. Georgia Tech finds itself only one game off the pace in the loss column. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick, Dick Mike. It's great to have you with us. Aaron Andrews will join us shortly. Dick, this is such a young league, the ACC, this year. So many freshmen, although they're great players. But when you look at the superstars, the kid's a sophomore, Tyler Hansborough.
Yeah, he really is the heart and soul of the North Carolina team. I remember against Georgia Tech last year, he scored 40 to break an ACC record at this freshman record on this floor, and it was a Dean Dome record. It goes through him. He's the catalyst. He's the guy that affects other clubs in preparing for North Carolina.
Well, we mentioned freshmen. Your star watch has two great ones.
Well, you talk about Diaper Dandy, and you talk about point guards that are excellent. Crittenden is sensational for Georgia Tech. And then you talk about Ty Lawson. He creates the tempo of the game with his explosive ability to go from one end to the other.
Take a look at the lineup, starting with the Jackets of Georgia Tech. And you'll see the youth in the backcourt with Crittenden, but Mario West, the senior, who's a tremendous defensive player, gets a start tonight. Smith, Dickey, and Young up front, very athletic, very good rebounders. They'll need to be tonight against North Carolina. A lot of youth on this club. Three freshmen starting, including Lawson and Ellington, but they are terribly talented. Rayshon Terry and Hansborough, the only veterans in the starting lineup. Aaron Andrews will work the sideline for us. Aaron, what do you have?
Mike, it'll be very interesting to see what Georgia Tech can get out of their freshman forward, Thaddeus Young, tonight. A bit under the weather. This week he missed a few practices with a high fever, and today he was pulled out of shoot around with a toothache. Now, his head coach, Paul Hewitt, told me it's so bad that he will undergo a root canal this Monday. Paul Hewitt said he doesn't know what to expect out of his second
Thanks very much. Georgia Tech has not won at North Carolina in 11 years. Hansbrough had it and lost it inside to Jeremy Smith.
They've also got that 14-game losing streak on the road, but they've won seven of their last eight, and the only loss was to Clemson by a basket with 2 seconds to go.
Young. One and done.
Young almost committed to North Carolina.
Just what they needed, another superstar freshman.
Paul Hewitt was able to convince him to play at Georgia Tech. I think the fact that Brandon Wright had committed to North Carolina certainly made his choice a little easier.
Georgia Tech starts man-to-man and switching outside. Mismatch here with Crittenden against Hansbrough. Tries to take advantage of it, can't hit the shot, out of bounds to Georgia Tech. And Paul Hewitt in his seventh season as the head coach at Georgia Tech. He was the 2001 ACC Coach of the Year.
Went to the Final Four in 2004. Lost to Connecticut for the national title. You know, he lost 11 in a row on the road last year, but that was a different team than this team. This team is certainly a lot different with Crittenden and certainly Young.
What a beautiful drive by Thaddeus Young, the freshman out of Memphis who started the last six at guard. Really gives him some height in the backcourt at 6'8". That's a tough matchup.
He's a big-time athlete.
Well, that was close to basket interference, wasn't it?
Right. I think Wright's going to get credit for it.
Freshman from Nashville, Tennessee. He's been double figures all year long. Rayshon Terry, they are going to give credit for the basket. Here's the turnover. They can't do this against the speed of Ellington.
That's what they do so well. North Carolina is so explosive. As our buddy Clark Kellogg used to say, spurtability. They can put spurts on you, Mike, so quick.
Ellington and Lawson can just fly. Roy Williams, National Coach of the Year. He's been that here. He's been that at Kansas. Won his national championship here.
Told me the best team that he's really ever had didn't win a national title. 1997, Kansas. They lost two games. Heartbreaker to Missouri and a heartbreaker to the ultimate national champs, Lou Olsen in Arizona.
Backdoor to Young, picked off by Hansbrough. He'll show you how to handle. Ellington tries to get the tip, can't keep it alive, comes out. Georgia Tech will have numbers. Crittenden with contact with Lawson, the lob. Tried to get too cute. Crittenden could have made an easy play out of that and tried to lob it up under the basket. It was a poor pass.
Yeah, he was trying to make the sensational play. He had 23 against Florida State in a big win, 88-80. That was a real strong win. They had that win over Duke as well.
He was very experienced as a freshman, playing an awful lot of AAU ball against older players.
He's very physical, very strong. He's got a great body.
West matched up right now with Ellington.
That's the key for North Carolina, Mike. They got to play on the defensive side. They didn't do that against Virginia Tech, and you got to credit Caldwell and certainly Gordon and Virginia Tech, but they did it against Clemson.
Dickey with a miss. Could have been a five-second call before the shot.
Look at that speed. Look at that quickness.
Looks like a lot like Raymond Felton. Scoop shot in the lane. Won't go for it.
He's got to get a little tougher on the defensive end because Raymond Felton brought defensive tenacity to the point guard spot.
These teams are 1-2 in the ACC in scoring, so we're going to get a lot of points tonight. There's an offensive foul on Young.
We're going to get some looks for Mr. Dickey inside. He's 20 for 23 in four ACC games. Look at those three. Those aren't your normal freshmen, my friends. These three guys are very special. That's the Duke, man. Duke Ellington's in the house. He's the Duke in a jump shot.
Terry got it. What a really soft touch.
You know, Mike, he came on strong last year, but he's been a little bit up and down this year. If he gets going consistently, think how good they're going to be.
Oh, absolutely. Hansbrough's going to be called for a hold.
Take a look at Terry, squaring his body, getting a great look. North Carolina's second in the nation in scoring, 88.1. VMI leads the nation, 102.5, but they're 4-12, so they don't guard anybody. You score 102 points, but you're 4-12, Mike. Something's not adding up. You're smarter than I am.
The Keydets. 5-second call. They'll turn it over. Roy Williams, if nothing else, is about defense. He wants these guys to play as hard as they can at both ends of the court, raise their hand when they're tired and come out because he will go 10 deep. You loaf, you're gone.
You're exactly right. And that's the part why he's not ready to say they're a great team. They have not committed to that side yet for 40 minutes.
Hansbrough, 16-footer. Wright got in there and Smith tied him up. He's got an interesting philosophy about it, Dick. He says, if my 8th, 9th, and 10th guys are better than anybody you could put on the court at that point, why not? I want to run them right into the ground.
Oh, exactly. And he's going to go to that bench, and he's got a very deep bench. They're playing without a kid who I think is important to them, Bobby Fraser.
Right.
You talk about experience on the perimeter, but they expect to get him back within a week. He's on a foot injury.
West, Rainbow.
That's
not much in the way of offensive rebounding, is there? Look at Lawson. Finds Hansbrough.
What great eyes. What great vision. Fraser says, that's my guy. Taking my spot. But let me tell you this. What about the vision to find the trailer? Oh, they love this team. This is not wine and cheese anymore here. Sammy Cassell getting the house here.
Paul Hewitt wants to talk to his kids. They've seen Carolina rack up 9 of the first 11. Back at the Dean Dome, it's 9-2. Paul Hewitt has talked to his kids. Clinton comes out of the timeout, runs into a double team. Gives it up to Anthony Morrow. This kid can light it up in a heartbeat.
Yeah, he's really been finding his shot. In fairness to him, you got to understand, he missed the whole preseason with a back injury.
Finally got his shooting legs back, and he's matched up right now with Lawson.
Mike, he led the ACC in three-point shooting last year.
Dickey threw it away. Look at his break, and Hansbrough can really run.
There is no one in America that runs the break as well as North Carolina. They are the best. Uno number one in transition. If you turn it over, Mike, it's lights out.
They get a lot of free hoops. Picked by Brandon Wright. 6 turnovers in 5 minutes for Georgia Tech. This could be over in a hurry. Lawson with a miss.
That's not a good sign. You can't turn the ball over against North Carolina.
Paul Hewitt trying to get a play he can get something out of.
They turned it over 22 times against Clemson on the road, but won easily because they shot so well.
And Clemson didn't. Smith, a pile, and it's answered.
Oh, you talk about a miracle. How would you like to play against that in the game of horse?
11-4.
I'd say take the H. It's right there, baby. Away on him.
It's pretty tough when those are the only shots you can make in the first 6 minutes of the ball game. Crittenden almost had it picked again. Defense has just been withering so far. Now Crittenden, 44% shooter from outside, misses that one.
As a team, they shoot close to 40% from the three.
But they haven't played against a defense like this.
And Georgia Tech right now is fourth in the nation in field goal percentage. Florida's number one at 54, Air Force 52, Georgetown 52, Georgia Tech 51.3. And you know, Mike, today it's very rare for teams to average 50%.
Yes, it is. Danny Green took an ill-advised shot at this end. Mario West into the lane. They're going to call a block. I think the officials, two of them, had different ideas. One was going to call block, one was going to call charge. Foul will be on Lawson. His first. And we've got a timeout.
Take a look at that circus shot. I went to see the three-ring Lombardi and Bailey Circus the other night. That shot belongs in a circus. Oh, what a miracle shot.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. There's good TV, there's better TV, and then there's DirecTV. And in part by the all-new 2007 Lincoln MKX.
This telecast is available in stunning high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivier.
Hey, Mike, we're going to take a look at the North Carolina transition game. As you see right now, Carolina winning by 7, 11-4. They really did a great job in transition, finding the trailer. Really important to communicate. You're going to see them right now finding the trailer right here. Freeze it. Right here. Now you're going to watch him come into this area here, and he's going to loop it back to him for a layup. There's Hansbrough. There's the look by Lawson, and there's the little layup. Communication is the key. Lawson getting a little rest right now. Assists per game. He's talking about North Carolina, the second in the nation. They average about 20 assists per game.
Morrow, let's see if Georgia Tech can get him a screen, get him free for a shot. He's got a great outside shot.
Yeah, he really does. He can really stroke that three.
Six turnovers, six shots, only two field goals. Make it three as Rashawn Dickey out of Clio, South Carolina, averages 9 points a game, gets his first bucket.
He has really been playing well lately. They just got to get him more looks. He'd be so effective against Duke. Had 21 in that victory. They're beating some good teams. They'd be Duke, they'd be Memphis, Georgia, Florida State.
Nice drive in reverse by Rashawn Terry. He has 7 points.
He's capable of putting a lot of points on the board. He was a surprise last year. He and Noel really stepped up for them, and they were a surprise team after winning a national title.
I mean, they lost more than anybody has ever lost, and they were really good. Thaddeus Young makes a nice move inside. Young has got some real skill.
He really does, and he's very quick. He's explosive. He's physically strong. I mean, he and Crittenden are going to be stars at Georgia Tech. I don't think there's any doubt about it.
A brick by Ellington, but the follow won't go either. This one's blocked. Stevenson had a point-blank crack at a follow and couldn't get it. Big Monday presented by Bud Light, part of Student Spirit Week here on ESPN. First at 7 Eastern, Connecticut against Louisville. Then at 9, Oklahoma and Mario Bogan against number 14, Oklahoma State. Also available in, or face Mario Bogan. Also available in high definition on ESPN HD.
Well, what about a performance by Bogan the other day against Texas? Great. 37 points, 20 rebounds. Against that sensational diaper dandy who got held today to 12 by Villanova. He beat Texas.
Terry has struggled a little bit. Only double figures in one of his last seven games coming in here.
If he gets going offensively, he's such a big plus for them. I'll be over at Louisville on Monday night with Dan Schumann, and we want to wish Dan the best. He and his wife Sarah tonight. It's the bar mitzvah of their son, and they're having a big party. Yes, sir, big party for the Schumanns.
Terry misses them both.
I think they're going to have a lot to cheer about this year at Georgia Tech, no matter what happens here tonight. I really do, Mike. I see some good things with this club, and it starts with Crittenden.
Roy Williams has gone to his bench. Terry, the only starter out there now. He can go this deep. Quentin Thomas is in to run the point. Jump hook won't go for Smith. No offensive rebounds. Thomas.
Nice pass.
Nice dish.
Great look by Thomas. Remember when he started here, it was turnover city. Even the beginning of last year, then the second half of last year, he was a major contributor, and he's had so many injuries.
Morrow can't get loose for a shot. Young will take the outside look. West, good offensive rebound.
He's a good athlete and a terrific defensive player. He's a high-energy guy. In fact, Paul, you would tell me tonight the reason he's starting him is because they have not had good starts, and they think he can provide it. There's the guy with the stroke.
There's Morrow, and he can just light it up from the outside. Anthony Morrow shooting 41.3% coming in.
They got a certain bounce to their step I didn't see last year.
Reach in by Peacock, another freshman, playing with that face mask because he broke his cheekbone four games ago.
He's been a real surprise for them. They didn't expect him to be able to contribute the way he has this year.
Morrow's a guy, if they can get him open, he's capable of knocking down three or four of those bombs in a row. Being very patient on this possession, and now Peacock will fire, averaging 6.5 points a game, and he hits one, and all at once Georgia Tech is back within two.
You know, Mike, they get a good ball movement and player movement and really patient on the offensive end to get the good shot.
Terry may have forced that one, but he buried it anyway. Rayshon Terry with 10 first half points.
Looks like he's going to have a big night tonight, Mr. Terry.
Young drove, had the ball knocked out of bounds. Dick's headlines coming up as we have hit the 10:09 mark. First half, it's Carolina by 5 over Georgia Tech. Almost halfway through the first half in North Carolina, Dick leading Georgia Tech by 5.
I tell you, talk about some headlines. You saw today, for example, Clemson really put the hurt on Boston College for their first loss. And one of the reasons, Sean Williams not in the lineup. He's finally put out of the school. How many chances can you give a guy, Mike? He had every opportunity. He let himself down. He let his teammates down. He let his coaches down. But most of all, let himself down. And take a look here. BC suffers their first ACC loss. Lute Olson loses to UCLA today. First pregame conference losing streak in 22 years. Wisconsin hangs on up at Illinois. Alabama behind Ronald Steele comes back from 19. And Kevin Durant held to 12.
I am glad you said Sean Williams let his teammates down, because that's exactly what he did. There was a kid with so many chances.
Ability.
BC had a chance to have a great year this year, Dave.
Yeah, there's no doubt. He let himself down, too, and his family. It's time to grow up. But you know the sad part of it all? He gets out of this. No basic situation to play on a collegiate team. It'll be in the NBA.
Sure.
And it'll be making money. And that's the sad part. I credit Al Skinner. Discipline. Learn to be a man. Handle accountability and responsibility.
Morrow makes another big shot. He's hit 2 from outside and cuts the lead to 2.
He can really stroke.
Yes, he can.
You almost feel every time it leaves his hand, it's going to hit nothing but nylon.
Ginyard is going to be called for an illegal screen and negates the basket. That's one on Marcus Ginyard, the sophomore from Alexandria, Virginia.
Sat down with Roy Williams earlier tonight, and he was really addressing the fact of, you know, he's had great teams, and he told me that team that he had with Jock Vaughn and Pierce and Pollard and LaFrance, he said, was so special, yet they didn't win the national title. Almost really.
That happens.
You said earlier to me tonight about how great players sometimes don't win it all.
Sure.
And people malign them, and it's so unfair.
Well, they picked up the intensity on defense in this set, and there's a travel on Smith, the 7th turnover, but they had been really good in the last 5 minutes after a horrible start.
Well, playing really tough on the basketball right there, as you look at Paul Hewitt. He's done a heck of a job at Georgia Tech, which is not an easy place. Bobby Cremins did a phenomenal job, that named the court after him, and Paul Hewitt played a vital role in making that happen.
Going to be a foul on Jeremy Smith,
you know, Paul
banging into Hansborough.
Mike, Paul was a journalist major, journalism at St. John's Fisher. He really reads and analyzes what's happening. He's trying to be the first time since 2004 to beat Carolina and Duke in the same year.
There's a pass as Lawson thought his teammate was going one way instead of the other. Check in with Aaron.
Mike, Paul Hewitt getting a lot of help this season from Jeremy Smith, who's trying to motivate his team before their very first game of the season. Smith took it upon himself to display the numbers 11 and 17 all over the Georgia Tech locker room, as well as put it in each individual stall of his teammates. He wanted them to know, that was our record last year, let's get better this season.
And you have to have that kind of leadership from the players too, Aaron. It can't just be the coaching staff.
They got to believe it. Now he's got to go out and demonstrate. They need some scoring out of Smith on the inside.
Morrow. Well, look at the hustle by Carolina. They're just going to bust it getting back. And Green went to the floor to save that one.
That reflects the teaching of Roy Williams. Diving, hustling, scrapping. They say the practice sessions were something else after they lost to Virginia Tech.
They took it out on Clemson.
Timing is the key of when you play people. That was not the time to play North Carolina after losing in that situation. Same thing for Clemson when they had to play Maryland. Up there in Maryland after Maryland lost to Miami.
There was the lob. Great defense as Ginyard got back and slapped it away. Tremendous anticipation on his part. Green, who can really fill it up from the outside as well. Ginyard, nice crossover, got to the baseline and laid it in.
I'll tell you, the GG guys, Ginyard and Green off the bench are so effective. Ginyard's an outstanding defensive player as well.
Crittenden trying to get inside.
He gives him a big plus off that bench. Very important now on the defensive side. There's Ginyard with the deflection. And then on the other side, a little isolation. What a change in direction. I mean, he made that look like Jimmy Hardaway years ago.
That was pretty. Here comes Wes Miller for the first time. Ginyard will come out. Miller, one of those kids, he gave up his scholarship so they could sign somebody else. This kid has really contributed a lot over the course of his career at Carolina.
Well, what a shooter he is.
Oh,
transfer, can really shoot the three.
Been a good point guard as well when they've used him in that situation. Double team down low. Thaddeus Young blocked. It's a tie-up possession arrow to Carolina.
Good defensive effort right there for the slow start early. Boy, Hewitt's club hanging in now, down only four.
You didn't look at the scoreboard this whole game. You'd think Carolina was up by about 12 right now. Instead, they're only up by four. Muhammad Fay, number 11, who's been starting, is in the ballgame for Paul Hewitt.
Yeah, he's long and lean, good defensive player. Got some good skills.
Green, top of the circle. Shooter's favorite spot. Gets the offensive rebound on the tip from Hansburn, scores.
Tell you again, there's that Green and there's Ginyard. So active off the bench. I'll tell you what Georgia Tech's done a better job of. They're keeping the ball away from Hansburn, and defensively, they're getting back in transition.
Fay wide open will take a three out of the corner. It's an air ball, but it goes right to Young. With the freshman nerves on the first shot, perhaps. Now he'll try it a little closer and got the roll. Nice. Muhammad Fay out of Dakar, Senegal.
He's a redshirt freshman, good low post position. He's got those long arms, very lean.
Hansbrough lost it on the way in, somehow got it back to Thomas. Nice pass, and Hansbrough is hacked by Fay. That'll be his first, but he saved the easy layup as Thomas, with great vision, poured it in there. We'll show you a different look at the Dean Dome from Chapel Hill when we come back. .658 to go in the half, Carolina by four. In 1986, this building, worth $34 million, opened for the first time, one of the most recognized athletic venues in America, the Dean Smith Center, named after the legendary coach, with 879 wins, two national titles, 11 Final Fours. The first game was against Duke. Number one Carolina beat the Blue Devils 95-92. What a way to start. The first basket scored by Carolina center Warren Martin off an assist by Kenny Smith. Overall, 246 and 47 so far. They're trying to make it 247 tonight, and they're up by four as Hansbrough will go to the line.
They're also trying to win their 1900th game.
Yes.
In North Carolina basketball history. Number one is Kentucky in 1941, Carolina at 1899, Kansas 1889. There's something there. Carolina doesn't want to be 3-for-3. Two of those three lost today. Kentucky to Vanderbilt, and Kansas lost to Robert Montgomery Knight, Texas Tech. Nice pass.
They got Carolina's defense on its heels that time. No pun intended.
Did a great
job. They
got
down quicker.
2-on-1. They're trying to jam on the inside.
Nice steal by West. You turn your head, he'll take it away from him.
He looks like he'd be one heck of a defensive back in football.
Senior out of Douglasville, Georgia. Georgia Tech hanging in there. That would have cut it to one. Long tip to West.
Psychologically, they need a statement win on a road to get that off their mindset. Losing 14 in a row on a road. Even though this is a different club than last year, who lost 11 in a row on a road.
Good double team. Miller, who's really good from outside.
Flat out shoot it, Mike. He's in the game. He can make shots. If he's wide open, you collapse inside. Nothing but nylon. That's his strong suit.
He's going to bring back the set shot, Dick.
And he plays hard on the defense.
Yes, he does.
You talk about maximizing your ability.
Young gives it off on the weave to Crittenden.
He's got to get going. Javaris has got to get going. Very talented.
Smith tried to get it to Dickey, and Dickey called for a three-second violation. Let's go to Dave Revson. He has a Sports Center 30 and 30. Dave?
All right, Mike, the Steelers are going to go with Vikings defensive coordinator Mike Tomlin as their new head coach. This confirmed by ESPN's Chris Mortensen. Official announcement expected in the next couple of days. And as Dick was just alluding to, Kansas's 10-game win streak coming to an end in Lubbock. Red Raiders get 19 from Daryl Dora, 14 from Martin Zeno. They win it by 5. Details Sports Center after the game. ESPN News anytime.
All right, thanks, Dave. Here's Lawson, wide open, top of the circle, and he buries it. Carolina really hurting Georgia Tech right now with threes.
If he gets effective from the perimeter shooting the three, that just takes his game way up.
Eight players have scored so far for the Heels. Smith, double team, hit and foul. Nice play by Smith to get the defense in the air. Big Monday presented by Bud Light on ESPN2 at 7 p.m. Lindsey Harding and the number one Duke Blue Devils against Kansas, Candace Parker, and the number four Tennessee Lady Vols.
Talk about a lady that's won a little bit in her career, Pat Summitt.
Hasn't she?
Gail Gesten-Gorosh, what a job. Krzyzewski and Gesten-Gorosh. Try spelling those two. And you belong in the spelling bee.
Got to buy a consonant at Duke.
Oh. Everybody's asking me tonight, what's happened to the Dukies? What's wrong with Duke? I said, excuse me? They lose Reddick, they lose Williams, and they're sitting at 16-3. 16-3, and what's happened to Duke?
Yeah, but they're not the Duke we know, Dick.
No, offensively they're not. We know that. I think they suffered tremendously with the offensive firepower they've lost. But I'll tell you one thing, Mike. They lock it up defensively, and they come to play on a defensive side.
And you're right. 16-3 isn't too bad for a down year, is it?
Oh, exactly. Because they're going to be back stronger than ever next year.
Terry gives it up to Lawson, 4:45 to go, first half. Good crossover, but taken away by West. He's dangerous. West into the lane, good, no call. Offensive rebound, and the follow is good by Muhammad Faye.
I like Faye, the way he's quick.
Yeah.
Bounces off the court, good offensive rebound. Good defensive effort in that possession by West.
I'll tell you what, West may be the best on-ball defender in this league.
He's very good. I'll tell you, kid, Crittenden has 23 against Florida State. He's got zero tonight, Mike. There's that offensive rebound. Nice pump fake. Good ball fake. You young kid should utilize that.
Thaddeus Young picks up his second foul.
You know,
Terry will go out and Green comes back in.
Everybody says the conference is a little down. Eight teams are in the top 40 in the RPI.
Miller. Rims out. Follow is blocked. Hansborough thought he had an easy one. Faye blocked the shot that's off of Hansborough.
Faye's doing a good job off the bench. He's been very productive for that. The RPI rates the Pac-10 1, the SEC 2, ACC 3. The VBDI, the Vital Ball Dome Index, disagrees with the RPI.
Who do you like?
I think you got to put the SEC number one. I really do.
Pac-10 2?
Yeah, and then the ACC.
Pac-10's a loose ball.
Pac-10's a lot better. Uh-oh! Oh! He tried the monster dunk.
And Mario West went for the monster block and picked up the foul, but he saved the easy one.
Saved the easy one, and he put a guy in the free throw line that is struggling. Brandon Wright was 3-for-11 in his last two games on a free throw line.
ESPN Student Spirit Week celebrates the energy of college basketball's fans. At North Carolina, they have not but one, but two student sections. Coming up on the UPS Halftime Report, Reese Davis, Jay Billis, Digger Phelps, Hubert Davis. They'll be following these stories and more. A steal for Alabama, Kansas, trouble at Texas Tech. The Steelers have a new coach. Digger Phelps working on his halftime stuff with Hubert. And Digger, we've got John Edwards in the house tonight. Maybe Digger and he can talk a little politics. Maybe Digger can get the former senator on his ticket.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. Digger, to me, I really believe he will admit it. I think he's always had aspirations to be a congressman, Senator Phelps. Come on, Mr. Phelps. He's got that look. He's got the political look. Look at Jay Billis is very right now analyzing, evaluating. Look at Hubert Davis. I mean, this is his house. He averaged 21.4 when he played here, and that was the second highest average. The only one higher in the last 35 years, Antoine Jameson.
Off the missed free throw. Carolina basketball up by 8. We're under 4 minutes to go first half. Ellington, that's his first long-range shot tonight. And the biggest lead of the game, a 34-23.
He's going to be the Duke of the trifecta, man. Duke Ellington, a little trap right there.
Morrow with a long, long three. West, great hustle, saved it to Fay.
Nice job by West to come up with that loose ball, very aggressive.
And a good catch by Fay. That was a bullet pass getting back inbounds.
You know, 8 guys have scored for North Carolina, and Brandon Wright's not one of them.
He averages almost 16 a game. Dickey faces up, missed the shot. And that foul's going to be on Morrow.
Brandon Wright hasn't made a field goal. He had 1 free throw, so it's 9 guys that have scored.
Check in with Aaron.
Mike, remember the last time these two teams met last season? UNC came back from being down by 20 points. And, oh, by the way, freshman sensation Tyler Hansbrough dropped 40 on Georgia Tech, making some history, the most points a freshman scored in an ACC game. That is something this Yellow Jackets team has referenced all season long. Like when a player is being lazy or not working out right, someone will yell, that's why a freshman will drop 40 points on you.
Hey, you know what the record was here?
He was great.
The record at the Dean Dome was 38, held by a guy who I thought left school too early, Joseph Forte, at 38. Where is he going? That name is a forgotten name.
You're right.
So many kids make bad decisions. We hear about those that make it. I just hope that some of these kids that we're reading about making mistakes, like Sean Williams, Kyle McElhaney down at Notre Dame, hope they learn from their mistakes and mature and get on with their lives in a positive way.
Because people will ask, what did Michael Jordan do? Well, his best was 39, and he was. Fay gets it into Smith. Double team. Blocked from behind by Rayshon Terry. Lawson, they had a 3-on-2, had to pull up.
Brandon Wright trying to post up deep inside. They missed him down in that low box.
Ellington, after hitting one, maybe feeling it, and couldn't hit two in a row. Crittenden slashes inside. Contact, ball knocked out of bounds. Out to Tech.
Jamar's having a tough night thus far in the first half here offensively. Look at Roy Williams, the youngest guy in terms of getting to 500. He got there quicker than anybody else in the 500 win mark.
Tell you what, Dick, his defense can make point guards look bad.
Served 10 years next to Michelangelo as an assistant coach. Bob Frederick gave him that opportunity, the AD at Kansas, and so many other guys that wanted that job, but he found the right guy in Roy Williams.
Crittenden shaking a little bit. He traveled. That's the 10th turnover by Georgia Tech. And there are the numbers on Roy Williams, the fastest to 500 wins, did it in his 19th season.
Yeah, Jerry Tarkanian did it in 20. Spoke to the Tark yesterday. Wants me to be a guest on his radio show. These days, everybody leaves coaching. They get radio, TV.
Terry thought he saw something that he didn't, toss the lob up there. Either that or it came out of his hand. West.
He's improved a little in that area, but that's still his weak point, making a perimeter shot.
Break for the heels, loose ball knocked out of bounds. And it's out to Georgia Tech.
Try to find that trailer. Tell you, the guy that ran the trail position in a break the best for Carolina was Brad Daugherty years ago.
Big Monday presented by Bud Light, part of Student Spirit Week on ESPN. Jim Calhoun in Connecticut will be taking on Rick Pitino's Cardinals. Then at 9 Eastern, it's Oklahoma against Oklahoma State. That's also available in ESPN HD.
Well, I'll be up here Monday night. Rick Pitino's club won today. They've won 8 out of 10. And Connecticut's in search of a statement win. Got beat by Indiana today at home. Indiana, by the way, has won 9 out of 10.
Carolina with 12 points off of Georgia Tech turnovers so far. That's the difference in the ballgame.
Well, Crittenden has 0 points, 0 for 3. As I said, he had 23 in the last game against Florida State. He's too important to this club.
Right now, Quentin Thomas matched up against him.
Nice backdoor
cut.
Peacock got so far underneath, he couldn't hit it from either side of the bucket.
Yeah, he never had the right angle, Mike, to lay it on the glass.
Nice look to get him the ball, though.
Yeah, good backdoor cut. There it is. Nobody rotates over. It looks like he's got an easy layup. Never was able to get the good angle.
Dickey on the inbound. Inbounds pass. Good defense by Thompson to get a hand up and knock it away. Georgia Tech being very, very sloppy with the ball.
Started the season off, and Maui did a good job beating Purdue with their good low post player, Landry. Then they beat Memphis. They beat John Calipari's team, which is having an outstanding year. How did Calipari let a guy like Thaddeus Young get out of Memphis?
Sometimes kids just want to get away from home. You know, you see it all the time.
No question. John's a great recruiter.
Ellington. Terry drives. No bucket, but a foul. No, stepped out of bounds.
I'm going to ask you. I know you really know the ACC. You always ask me questions. I'm going to ask you.
Uh-oh.
How do you evaluate and look at this team versus the team that won the national title 2 years ago?
I think his team is more talented. I have never seen a single team loaded with this many guys who can play. He can go nine deep with guys who were All-Americans in high school. And I mean, everybody's All-Americans. And the way he coaches, these guys have a chance by the end of this year, no matter how young they are, of winning it all. This is a great collection of talent.
Well, they were my preseason number one, and I haven't changed yet.
I don't blame
you. I haven't changed. I agree with you. I think by the end of the year, this is going to be the club to beat in tournament time.
If they keep playing defense like this, I don't know anybody that can stay with it.
Hey, Georgia Tech is fortunate they're only down 11 because really, yeah. I mean, they're really, if they can make a 3 year.
Good drive, no basket by Jeremy Smith. And Carolina can play for the last shot of the half.
Jeremy's not able to finish around the basket. He's been struggling a little bit offensively on the inside.
Roy Williams quickly gets a timeout. He didn't want these guys getting off the shot and allowing Georgia Tech to have another possession in this half. Are you talking about nationally? Here's the top 10. Florida back on top. I think you can throw a blanket over, what, the top 7?
Yeah, I'll tell you one thing, though. Florida really right now is playing better than anyone in America. They had their slips early. I think teams go through those slips. Hey, Mike, before we go any further, I have to do this for a youngster back in Bradenton. I want to wish him all the luck in the world. He's going to have a bone marrow transplant. He has a very rare blood disease. His name is Anthony Naquin. He's from Bradenton Christian High School. His dad coaches. And I want you to know, Mike and I and all the people, wish you the best, Anthony. You're going to Cincinnati for that operation. Everybody's in your corner. Be positive. Be strong. Have faith, and I know you're going to come through it in great shape.
All right, Anthony, good luck to you. 23.6 seconds to go. First half. Carolina will have the ball. They're up by 11.
They've really played well defensively. Offensively, they haven't been as effective in their 5-on-5 half-court game. But I think Roy Williams will be happy against a good Georgia Tech team to be up double figures going in at halftime.
Lawson will milk the clock till they get down around 10.
I thought we were going to see much more of an explosive game.
I did too. I thought it was going to be 195.
Yeah, I really did.
They're going to have to work to get to that. Lawson to Miller. And they're going to say Miller stepped on the sideline.
The one area where Paul Hewitt's club's done a nice job, they have really contained the interior game. The interior game of Wright and of Hansbrough. Sean Madry doing a great job for his stats, pointing out the numbers to us.
So Tech has 5.5 seconds.
Hey, wishing good luck. I know it's a tough time for our buddy Marty Aronoff. His mom passed away. We want to send Marty our sympathy.
We love Marty. Terry off the steal with a miss. That'll be the last possession of the half.
Good defensive effort by North Carolina. Both clubs really not in rhythm on the offensive side.
It's the turnovers that have hurt Georgia Tech. They've lost 10 net points on turnovers, and they are down by 11. Aaron Andrews has Roy Williams. Aaron?
Thank you, Mike. Coach, what has your defense done to hold Javaris Crittenden scoreless tonight?
Well, he's a great player. We know he's going to get his. We tried to do a good job of building a wall in front of him to stop his penetration, but we turned it over four of the last six possessions, or it would have been nicer in if you get a better shot. But we've got to continue to do a better job on the defensive, on the offensive end, and hopefully maintain what we've done defensively.
What's the biggest adjustment your team needs to make going into the second?
Stop stepping on a stupid line. You know, it's sort of simple, but we had four turnovers stepping on a stupid line. You learn that in the playground, you have out of bounds.
Thanks, Roy.
We're at halftime of Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. The score 34-23. We'll be back with the UPS halftime report right after this.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by GMC, engineered to the highest standard, professional grade, and Best Buy. For the ultimate football experience, get HD done right at Best Buy. Welcome to the UPS Halftime Report.
For all the talk of the freshman, and rightfully so, the veteran, Rayshon Terry, got North Carolina off to a good start. 10 points in the first half. Tar Heels up on Georgia Tech by 11 at the break. Hubert Digger, Jay Reese, all here with you. Glad to have you along on the UPS Halftime Report. This morning on College Game Day, Digger put Kansas on upset alert going into Lubbock to take on Texas Tech. Dora the Explorer draining the three. Red Raiders up by 9, and here's Jarius Jackson.
Jarius Jackson had a big game. Did it what he wanted to do. Zeno and Jackson combined for 29 points.
But Kansas would come roaring back. Down by 2. Darrell Arthur gets it inside. We're tied up. Sharon Collins would miss. But eventually, on the other end, Texas Tech would get the run out. Martinsino would finish.
Well, Martinsino had a good game. Texas Tech really played well offensively. They did a solid job defensively, making Kansas shoot over the top. Kansas only shot 4 free throws in the whole game.
69-64. Arizona and UCLA Wildcats have been struggling. Final seconds of the first half. Darren Collins is showing his teeth.
Well, he's one of the fastest point guards in the country. Goes length of the court for the easy two, but no defense from Arizona the entire game.
Cats trying to avoid losing 3 straight Pac-10 games for the first time since Lute Olson's first year. Marcus Williams drains the 3. Cats within 2, but Aaron Aflalo was tough.
Aaron Aflalo had 22 points in this game. He hits big shots even when there's contact. He is strong on both ends of the floor, and he was stronger mentally, I thought, than any Arizona player on the floor.
Dime hit the winner last week against USC, and he leads the Bruins past Arizona. Cats have lost 3 in a row and 4 out of 5. Ole Miss and Florida, Billy Donovan and the Gators. Joakim Noah had a huge game. Noah finding Corey Brewer.
Boy, he just made anything happening. He got the assist. He goes 9 from 10 in the field, 24 points, 12 rebounds, and his defense, unbelievable.
Corey and Green off Brewer. Flying through the air. Gators built a big lead in this game, but Ole Miss started coming back.
Well, Ole Miss played some 2-3 zone. They pressed, they trapped, and they turned over the Florida Gators. Florida had 18 turnovers, a +7 advantage for Mississippi.
Poor Enel Polonese is going to have to visit the orthopedic surgeon after being the victim of that Brewer move. Gators win by 9. Wisconsin and Illinois, Brian Randall in traffic to tie the game at 57, but Rich McBride would spot up and hit the 3.
Well, he's a guy that brought him back. He had 5 threes in this game, a total of 15 points, but too much defense, too much senior play from Wisconsin.
And answering that 12-3 Illinois run, Greg Steensma with the jumper. Cameron Taylor gets a shot blocked. Pick up with Flowers and put it down. And then, no, check that. That's Taylor that knocked it down. 71-64, the final there. Oklahoma State and Texas A&M. Sean Sutton trying to avoid the letdown after that triple overtime victory over Texas. Dominique Kirk steps up and hit the 3. Aggies up by 8. And Taunus Kavalauskas uncontested.
This is a very good defensive team. They wind up getting a lot of points off of their defense. But the thing that sets Texas A&M apart is they get down and they guard you for 40 minutes.
Kavalauskas finding Donald Sloan, 15-point lead for the Aggies. James Uncurry trying to bring back the post.
Big game, double figures. He's the only guy keeping them close in this game. It's not over yet.
The 5-point lead at that point, and then on the inside, good pass to Joseph Jones for the stuff. On top. 54-45. Huge game for Greg Oden against the overmatched interior players for Iowa.
He's just staying out of foul trouble. Iowa's really struggling. You got to look at Steve Alford, what he's trying not to do, but look at Oregon making a big win at home against Cal, Jay.
Well, Aaron Brooks, again, leading the way with 22 points, an outstanding player. He's carried the load all year for the Ducks.
Still to come on the UPS Halftime Report. Turn our attention to the coaching carousel in the NFL, and Bill Cowher's gone, and the Steelers now have their man.
This Halftime Report is delivered by UPS. What can Brown do for you? This Halftime Report is delivered by UPS. What can Brown do for you?
On the eve of the conference championship games in the NFL, the team that won it all last year, the Steelers, have a new head coach. Mike Tomlin, Tony Dungy's disciple, worked as defensive coordinator of the Vikings, will take over for the departed Bill Cowher. Back to college hoops, Georgia and Alabama waning seconds of a tie game. Tied to come back from 18 down. Ron Steele off one leg.
Ron Steele scored the last 5 points for Alabama. Look at this defense by Georgia. You can't run away from the ball, especially late game.
Steele wins it 78-76. Texas falls to Villanova. Scotty Reynolds had 26.
Durant 1 point in the second half. That was the difference. Big win for Villanova.
SEC West team still without a conference win on the road as Arkansas blows out LSU.
Well, LSU wasn't playing any defense. Arkansas, it was the Stephen Hill show. He was 8 of 10 from the field, getting easy dunks for Arkansas.
Yeah, and, you know, apparently he's got the strength of Samson with the long hair against Big Baby.
It was good for him.
He was strong inside. Strong all over the court has been North Carolina. Georgia Tech probably fortunate that the deficit is not larger than 11 right now. What's the key to the second half?
Well, for Georgia Tech, I mean, defensively, they're doing a great job of keeping points out of the paint. Hansbrough and Wright only have 7 points. Offensively, get the ball down to Rayshon Dickey and find Anthony Morrow on the perimeter. He has 2 3-pointers in the first half.
I think that's the key. I think obviously you get 13 turnovers for 12 Carolina points and 2 for 10 on threes. You've got to work to try to get the ball inside so you can get fouls on Carolina's front line, and that seems to be the difference in this first half.
For Georgia Tech, Javaris Crittenden has to settle down. He did not score in the first half. He was 0 for 3. Also turned the ball over 5 times. He's got to attack more. When Crittenden attacks, Georgia Tech's a better team. I agree with you, Reese. They should be down 20. They're lucky to be in this.
Yeah, 5 turnovers, 0 assists in the first half for Crittenden. The second half, not far away. Georgia Tech and North Carolina. Kylan Lawson, he has an assist. He found Psycho T, who's only 34 points short of the number he put on the Jackets last year.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Sonic. It's not just good, it's Sonic good.
Time in Chapel Hill, where North Carolina is leading Georgia Tech 34-23. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. The lead is 11. Mike Patrick, Dick Vitale, Aaron Andrews, great to have you with us. Anything you've seen in the first half that would tell you Georgia Tech can come back from 11 down?
Well, I'll tell you one thing, Mike. I think the 4 minutes here after halftime are so important to Georgia Tech. They got to go on a spurt. And if that's going to happen, Crittenden's got to get him down. They've done a great job containing his penetration. You know, you're not going to turn the ball over 13 times in a half and have a chance to win on the road against a team like Carolina.
Especially where they turned it over, led to a lot of easy baskets. Shot clock at 5, the drive and the block. Defense has been so, so good for North Carolina.
Last 8 possessions, they didn't play well, North Carolina. And Hansbrough and Wright have been quiet.
Hansbrough a little short against defense. At least they've held him 34 under what he got yesterday. Aaron?
Mike, I had a chance to speak with head coach Paul Hewitt coming out of the half, and he told me the biggest problem with his offense right now is they're just standing around. His freshman guard, Jabaris Crittenton, he says that's a product of the offense not doing what they had practiced all week. He said there is a positive. We held UNC to just 34 points. Now if we could do it without turning the ball over, I'd be happy.
I can understand that.
That's a pretty good assessment, because ball movement and player movement are so important. When you stand and watch, everybody takes a picture to become the Kodak man.
Crittenton did not have an assist. Shot clock's at three. Crittenton did not have assists in the first half. And he leads the ACC in assists. He had five turnovers, and right there, they lost track of the shot clock, and it's another turnover.
Yeah, it's tough to come back if you're not going to be able to get shots. And right now, North Carolina's defense has been stifling. This is probably as good defensively as they've played. I know they played well against Clemson with their pressure.
Morrow comes in. He's the guy who can light it up in a hurry for them. They'll probably need some long-range bombs from him to have a chance. Ellington for the heels. Foul inside as Rayshon Terry goes for the offensive rebound, and he's fouled.
They got to get some looks for Anthony Morrow. They really do, Mike. They got to set him off screens, find some open looks for him. Boy, Williams wins that title here at his alma mater, 2005, with Raymond Felton and May and McCants.
Thaddeus Young picked up his third personal.
Marvin Williams also came off the bench on that club. Four guys go to the NBA in the first round. They were winners, Mike. One thing about Felton and May and those kids, they were winners.
They worked really hard, didn't they? Hands fall right down the lane, and Young, with those three fouls, just let him go.
Well, what a nice tandem right there. Brandon Wright with the little bounce pass. Two inside guys playing off each other.
36-23. Crittenton gives it up to Morrow. Whistle away from the ball. Paul Hewitt wants to talk about it.
They did a great job playing together, Wright and Hasbro on the inside.
Paul Hewitt with a timeout, 36-23, heels by 13. .1801 to go in the ballgame. This telecast available in stunning high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia, downtown Chapel Hill, North Carolina. One of the prettiest areas in the entire country. North Carolina right now with a 13-point lead. These kids are loaded.
I'll tell you one thing, great seeing you. I haven't seen you in
Thank
a long
you, sir.
Time.
My pleasure.
I mean, you did a great job in college football, but I'm not shocked.
Morrow got it to Dickey, missed point blank. Follow won't go, but the second one does, as Jeremy Smith just continued to battle inside. He has five.
I'll tell you one thing, they got some great recruits coming in next year, Georgia Tech. Donnie LaWall plays for Eddie Martin at Norcross High School out in the Georgia, Atlanta, Georgia area. Maurice Mo Miller and Lance Storr is coming in. Three guys that are going to help them big time.
Wide open inside. Within 6 feet of Brandon Wright. I realized he didn't have a field goal, but come on.
Hey, Mike, I can make that layup. Let me go out there. I'm 67 and I can make that layup.
Not from that height you can. Dickey gets inside.
Hey, where do you see my commercial with DiGiorno? It's coming up. You'll see me dunking all over the place. Nice to have a harness.
Just suspend your believability for a little bit. There's Ellington slashing in. He has seven.
And a foul on.
Foul's going to be on Lawson as he went for the steal.
Les Jones with that call, reaching in. I mean, Brandon Wright was so open. Boy, you can't believe it. I mean, take a look here. I mean, he's wide open. He says, get me the rock, baby. And look at those legs. Man, how long and lean. He scored double figures all year, except tonight's got three.
Thaddeus Young thought somebody else had Brandon Wright. Obviously, nobody else did.
Lack of communication. That's the key in basketball. If you want to be a good team defensively, guys have to communicate with one another.
40-27. This is the freshman Crittenton out of Atlanta. Wide open is Fay. Rimmed out on that. The rebound to Wright. He's triple teamed and finally fouled.
You know, Mike, the score was 24-20 when Wes Miller and Lawson hit back-to-back threes.
Big Monday presented by Bud Light on ESPN2, 7 o'clock. Lindsey Harding and number one Duke against number four Tennessee, led by Candace Parker.
I mean, you talk about getting to 1,000 mark. Pat Summitt's going to get to 1,000 before everyone.
Muhammad Fay with his second foul. This is Thomas beating the press. They got it to Hansbrough. Nice play by Peacock, knocking it away.
There's a look at Pat Summitt. Look at those wins. 930. I mean, that's the most all-time. Men's, women's, you talk about seven times coach of the year. Boy, Williams has been coach of the year six times.
Elton's knocked out of bounds.
They're doing a great job, though, keeping the ball away from Hansbrough, who had a field day here last year.
40.
Dean Dome record, also an ACC freshman record.
Well, it's a problem playing this team. I mean, you can hold a couple of guys down, but they're also talented. You can't stop them all. Thomas does not like to shoot, gets to Green. Green with a miss, the rebound to Dickey.
Well, Thomas doing a good job making some good decisions. That was a heck of a pass right there. He just missed that mid-range shot.
Britton had slashed his way in, then blew the layup. Got it back, and he's tied up by Green. Crittenden, I think, is waiting on somebody to come up and get a piece of that, or at least challenge him. Nobody did, and he missed it.
Yeah, Javarish really having a tough night. He's a great athlete with super speed. He pushes the ball well, has a good assist to turnover ratio. His last four games, been 4-1. But tonight, look at that pass.
Green, beautiful feed to Hansbrough.
You know what they love doing, Mike? They love sharing the ball. They are unselfish for a dominant team, similar to Pittsburgh. I saw that with Pittsburgh earlier this week. They really passed the ball so well.
It's the biggest lead of the night, Dick. 15 at 42-27.
And 10 years in a row, they haven't been able to win here.
Working on 11. Crowd wanted a travel, shot clock down to 5. Crittenden gives it off to the side. The jumper is good. Peacock hits the baseline, too.
He's got that nice little jumper. Needs a range jumper. Too many layups.
What a pass to Wright.
They just pass the ball. They get a thrill. You know, Mike, that becomes contagious. Everybody
sure
wants to become part of it. As a coach, you really enjoy that, watching kids play, sharing the ball.
Crittenden will pull up and take a three. He's unsuccessful on getting inside, unsuccessful getting assists. Why not bury one from outside?
He's a big-time player. We have not seen the real Javarish Crittenden tonight. And that's really because of the defense by North Carolina.
Green guarded by Fay. Oh, a nice head fake by Ellington. Can't hit the shot, but Hansbrough is there. He's clobbered from behind by Mario West.
Such a desire he has, Hansbrough.
Oh. Terry Francona, his daughter Leah, who's being recruited as somebody to play softball at North Carolina. We'll talk with him when we come back.
Well, you never know who you're going to find here at a North Carolina Tar Heel game. Michael Jordan, Dean Smith. What about Terry Francona, manager of the Boston Red Sox? Obviously, you're part of a pretty storied franchise with the Red Sox, but a lot of people would say Tar Heel basketball is right up there. What do you think of this environment, your first time at a basketball game here?
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. Going to have a daughter going here and another one maybe going here. This is a pretty neat place. And anytime you're in the same building with Dickie V, you got to feel pretty honored.
All right, we got Dickie V, but how about another guy we got to talk about, Dice K. Matsuzaka. What has Boston been like since you guys signed him?
Well, it's been crazy before we signed him, and it got even crazier after we signed him. I think we got a pretty special pitcher. I hope we did, because I want to come back here next year and still be the Red Sox manager.
Well, we got to put you on the spot here. Will Dice K. Matsuzaka have Roger Clemens in the rotation? What is it going to take to get him to sign?
Well, my best guess would be deep pockets. And unfortunately, there's a few teams that have those.
Terry, thank you so much. Actually, you were recruited by North Carolina.
Yeah, I sure was. A long, long time. A lot of hair ago.
Thanks, Tito. Looking forward to seeing you in April.
Thanks very much.
Guys, send it over there.
I'll tell you one thing. He's one of the nicest guys you could ever meet for a guy in the sports world. And with Matsuzaka and Beckett and Schilling, watch out. But Clemens will be in the Yankee rotation with Pettit.
Red Sox parted with some bucks, didn't they?
$50 million just to get the rights to talk to him.
Yeah,
that's your kind of money.
Yeah,
$50 million to talk to him.
Yeah.
just to say hello.
Somebody gives me $50 million, they can talk to me all I want. Young with a miss.
Imagine getting $50 million just for the rights to talk to him.
Well, he didn't get it. His team in Japan.
Yeah, he only got about 45.
Yeah, afterward. Smith powers his way in, will draw the foul. Showed a lot of power. 6'7", 232. The junior out of Fort Worth, Texas.
Tell you one thing right now for North Carolina, they contained Hansbrough and Wright in the first half, and they got 10 of North Carolina's 12 points here in the second half. Roy Williams always coaching, working that sideline. He loves what he's doing. He's got this program in high gear. I don't think there was any doubt, whatsoever when he came here that he was the right choice for this job.
Smith at the line. This is the ninth best, if you can put it that way, free throw shooting team in the ACC. There's some people that just can't put the ball in the hole from 15 feet away.
And that certainly hurts you in terms of close basketball games. Teams that beat them on the road in Miami, Vanderbilt. They lost on the road as well to Vanderbilt, Miami, and also Clemson in a heartbreaker. A real heartbreaker is looking for Hewitt right there.
That foul's on Mario West. Let's take a look at tonight's KFC three-point bucket storyline, Dick.
Well, you take Georgia Tech right there. Season shooting 40%, only 3 for 11. 3 for 11, that's Brick City. That's not going to get it done on the road. It's a struggle right now for them to get anything going offensively.
And credit North Carolina's defense for that.
Lawson taped up his wrist.
Same wrist he hurt before. Terry with a miss off of North Carolina out of bounds. Georgia Tech's not done. There's plenty of time left. They're only down by 13.
You know, last year, North Carolina goes to the tournament. Kind of surprised a lot of people that it was good, but then they got bumped in the second round by George Mason, who beats North Carolina, beats Michigan State, and Connecticut to go to the Final Four.
Pretty good run, wasn't it?
One of the great guys, Jimmy Larranaga.
Jim Larranaga.
I'll tell you this, Mike. I think that's the greatest story in my 28 years.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, George Mason to a Final Four. Who could ever believe it?
Young hits the jumper, 46-36.
See, they just don't go away. That's one thing I like about the mental attitude of these kids. They still play hard, but you got to defend.
Terry, nice drive.
But nobody rotated over to close the driving angle.
Rayshon Terry has a dozen. We've gone under 13 minutes.
Here's two of the best type of dandy freshmen going head-to-head at the point guard slot, Lawson and Crittenton.
Foul away from the ball on Georgia Tech.
See, 1-on-1, nobody rotates over. Nobody takes and cuts off that driving angle. It's a great year this year for freshman point guards. Have two of them here tonight, Lawson and Crittenton. Think about DJ Augustine down at Texas. Certainly outstanding. Michael Conley, who we'll see next week in Columbus for Ohio State. Jerron Collins also, good player at Kansas.
Terry, nice dish to Hansbrough, and Hansbrough went down hard. He's got to be careful. He hurt his back last Monday in practice, took a huge fall.
I'm surprised he doesn't get hurt more often as hard as he plays. He has so much desire. Psycho T, they call him. He loves to work. He's got great work ethic. He's a coach's dream. He really is.
Now, there was the second contact. It's going to be called an intentional foul, and it should be. Who was that on, John? It's on Peacock. That's his second. Well, he just reached up and grabbed Hansbrough by the collar.
Earlier this year, he was disqualified from the game for...
That was a flagrant foul. This was not.
This was intentional. Yep, this was intentional. Try to take away the opportunity of him having a layup.
But this is a big play because it gives the ball back to North Carolina after they hit the free throw.
Well, they're up 14. They can't get any steady stops right now.
Right.
Every time they make a little bit of a run, here comes an open layup, and boom, it's up to 12-14. Tough to get back.
And because of the Heels defense at the other end, they're not getting any easy shots at all.
Well, North Carolina's so talented, Mike, as you said. This club has had two slip-ups, Virginia Tech and Gonzaga. Gonzaga in the NIT. They collapsed all over Hansbrough in that game.
Hansbrough called Well, they're just going to say no foul. He just lost it out of bounds.
And the loss to Virginia Tech. Dowdell and certainly Seth Greenberg's kids played so well, and Gordon and
great
company.
Backcourt.
I mean, they blew him away. It was a blowout until the last 3 minutes.
Don't you think that's a function of North Carolina's youth, the fact that they can be surprised like that?
Yeah, they can. There's no doubt. I think you've got to learn to mature. I think you said it best earlier. They have to learn to play on every possession for 40 minutes. That's what Felton and those kids did so well, and that's why I gave them a little edge over this club.
But by the middle of March, watch out.
Because Roy Williams will not tolerate it, as you said. If they don't play with intensity and emotion, they're going to sit down.
Because it's not like he doesn't have options. He can go down that bench and say, okay, you five guys in there.
He's got options just like you do with all those stocks. You got all those options.
50-36, Carolina over Georgia Tech. Ginyard is back in. He hasn't had an awful lot of playing time tonight. Hansborough into 14 feet. Nice shot.
Well, you know what he did really well there that he would not have done last year? He would have made the extra dribble, maybe a try. He pulled up, he had poise, and he made that little medium range jump shot.
16 points, 10 of them here coming in the second half in the first 8 minutes. Smith open, hesitated, and then shot. Morrow, offensive rebound.
They got to get him looks.
Yeah, they do.
He can flat out shoot the basketball.
I'm really surprised they haven't set up a bunch of screens for him. He's the guy who can shoot them back into the game.
He's one of the great shooters in America.
Right. Great pass. Reverse layup by Ginyard.
What a terrific job by Reagan Wright. He knows traffic, looks to the opposite side. We call that the zigzag maneuver. Catch the ball from the strong side, go to the weak side.
That was pretty, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was really pretty. They're so unselfish. They really love sharing the ball.
The miss by Crittenden. Here comes Lawson back the other way.
The Jamie Dixon kids do the same thing up there in Pittsburgh.
Pass and a save by Ginyard. 13 on the shot clock.
Tell you what's impressed me in North Carolina. Their execution, 5-on-5. Usually young clubs have really a lot of lack of patience.
Right. Ginyard, offensive rebound, a fresh 35.
I tell you, Ginyard and Green are so productive off the bench.
How hard is it to keep a team this deep satisfied with playing time, Dick?
I think that's a great point. But you know what keeps them satisfied? As long as you're winning, I think when you're losing, then comes all the moaning and groaning. Kids can't moan and groan now when you're winning.
Yeah. Rashawn Dickey, good defensive play for Georgia Tech. They're down by 16. They're going to have to score on a lot of possessions right now. Dickey sets a screen. Ginyard goes down hard, and it's going to be on Dickey.
It was an illegal screen. Can't get anything off their defense to get some layups. They can't get anything Georgia Tech in terms of off the defense.
Gene Hansborough enjoying his son's big second half. 16 points, 10 of them to half. There he is dragged down by his collar. Everybody's grateful that the superstar sophomore is okay. Here we go.
Magic in this house tonight. And here comes the crowd.
Oh, it is super scintillating, sensational, baby.
Are you kidding me? I don't remember ever being in a louder building.
Student Spirit Weekend. They've been laughing it up tonight at Carolina. They're up by 16 points over Georgia Tech with 10:20 to go.
Oh, look at that. He's having a blast, man. I tell you, they got a lot of spirit here. It's one of the great universities in America. Chancellor sitting behind us. James Moiser sitting right behind us.
I hope that kid's a good fighter.
I know he's got to be a good student, man. If he only got in this school, it is tough. Oh, look at the back.
Oh, great pass by Miller. Miller ended up at the high post, and he fed the layup.
Doing such a great job of finding their open people, good motion offense. Watch this to the weak side. Freeze it right here. So he's going to catch the ball here. Now the defense is going to come here, and he's going to look opposite right here, and the guy's going to be coming for a layup. You're going to watch right here. There's the dump down, the backdoor cut, the reverse layup. Good play right there. Good pass by Brandon Wright. I'll tell you, ready for this? Right and Hansbrough, Mike, had 7 points total in the first half. They already got 22 in the second half. So you got to take a chance. You shut down the perimeter guys, they hurt you on the interior. Shut down the interior in the first half, they hurt you on the perimeter.
Pick your poison.
That's balance.
10 minutes to go, and it's 56-38.
Paul Ewing wants to get some motion offensively. Keeps signaling for them to get some motion.
Great Young move. Slashes through a double team. Thaddeus Young, what a future he has. Look at Thomas, hustles it back the other way. Miller for three, no. Green offensive rebound. Nice. Thomas, no look, and the jam.
The Red Love passing around. The Red Love finding the open man. They're so unselfish. They want to play for one thing. The name of that jersey, North Carolina. It's all about winning and representing a school that has an incredible tradition.
Quinton Thomas, super pass, wide open back the other way. And the miss, Fay. But a wide open 18-footer, couldn't hit it. Smith nearly turned it over. Fay gets it inside again, blocked from behind by Thompson. The defense has just been withering by North Carolina.
Oh, the defense. Now look at the passing. I think two factors. That's the great look by Thomas. He's a different player. He's absolutely a different player than we saw when he arrived here as a freshman. And he took him on most Final Four journeys. North Carolina's got 16, UCLA 15, Duke 14, Kentucky 13. Kentucky gets beat by Vanderbilt, former assistant to Roy Williams. I think this guy does a great job at Vanderbilt, Kevin Stallings, and doesn't get a lot of notoriety. He doesn't operate with some of the things that other schools have going for him, but he does a terrific job.
Hansbrough double-teamed. They got it away from him, and Thaddeus Young put it up and in. Thaddeus Young with 11. Here's a full-court press and a foul as they got it to Hansbrough. Let's go to Dave Revson. He's got a 30-30.
Indeed I do, Mike. Steelers going to go with Vikings defensive coordinator Mike Tomlin as their new head coach. This has been confirmed by ESPN's Chris Mortensen. We expect an official announcement in the next couple of days. And Kansas, the 10-game win streak coming to an end in Lubbock. Red Raiders get 19 from Daryl Dora, 14 from Martin Zeno. They win it by 5. Details, SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News anytime.
Boy, if you think that was a strange choice for the Steelers, keep in mind the Rooneys don't pick a coach very often, and he lasts a long, long time.
A great family to work with. I was in Pittsburgh, and everybody speaks so highly of the Rooney family.
And rightfully so.
I think we're going to see Bill Cowher pop up somewhere next year. Oh, yeah. Is there any doubt about it?
I think he'll be back. He's down in this area, bought a house in Raleigh. He had played, of course, at North Carolina State. There was some speculation that he might have gone back there as a college coach. I think he just wanted the time off.
Yeah, and the bidding will begin next year.
Yeah.
His daughter's doing a great job at Princeton.
Another turnover. Thomas tries to save it and does. So unselfish, as you said, that
they really make the extra pass. Always looking for one another, moving the ball. Turned it over there. I've got numbers right here.
Crittenden looked like a charge, called a block.
I thought it was a block, Mike.
Did you?
But he did not have position. Yeah, I really did. I'll tell you one thing, though. Crittenden and Young are going to be star players. We're not seeing it tonight, but I'm telling you, both guys are talented.
Exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. There's good TV, there's better TV, and then there's DirecTV. And in part by Pontiac, the official performance machines of the NCAA.
Texas A&M looking to get to 16-2 for the first time in 47 years, taking on Oklahoma State. Big showdown of the Big 12, Marlon Pompey. The Aggies held Oklahoma State to 32% shooting. They win it 67-49.
Top 10 right now. On the right, the results of this week. You see Kansas with that loss, the big loss to Texas Tech.
Well, big win by UCLA today over Arizona. That game's at home. Wisconsin wins two on a roll, beats Purdue and Illinois in a tough game today.
Arizona with a three-game losing streak.
Yes,
that happens about once every 40 years, doesn't it?
First time in 22 years. Let's get his crowd now. Oh, they're loud. We got to get Sammy Cassell here. I'm going to bring Sam Cassell here. Remember years ago, Florida State.
Called it the wine and cheese crowd.
Listen to this place. Oh, does Roy Williams have this place jumping with jubilation?
It's really made a difference, too, Dick, when they moved those students down to the floor.
That was smart. Belongs to the kids. That's why it's so effective at Cameron Indoor Stadium.
Oh, yeah.
They're right on top of you, the student body. Doesn't it belong to the students? It belongs to the kids.
Crittenden had an off night, hits a pair of free throws. 58-44. The biggest lead of the night was 18.
Points off turnovers, 18 for North Carolina. Georgia Tech only four. That's almost a 5-1 ratio. I think they're going to be a tough club to track. I think they're going to get layups.
Even better, dunks.
I knew you were going to come out with that. I know you too well. We've worked 20 years together.
Yes, sir.
We have all the time gone. Paul wishes that clock moves. Look at this right here. Double up, bring the ball, attack. Attack pressure. So many teams, Mike, we see with pressure, they're content to get the ball over the midcourt mark instead of attack for the score.
That was four on Fay, who has been a very good defender as a freshman. Good shot blocker.
But they got the talent that can attack. In fairness to a lot of guys, they don't possess the kind of personnel to be able to do some of the things you're watching North Carolina do.
Terry, the senior, cannot complete the three-point play.
I think that Virginia Tech loss was a wake-up call for North Carolina.
Paul Hewitt seeing it slipping away now with only 7:38 to go. His club down by 16. They continue to make the kind of mistakes that would cut short any kind of a comeback. And Mario West just picked up his fourth personal foul of the ball game. Big Monday presented by Bud Light on ESPN at 7 o'clock Eastern on Monday. Connecticut and Louisville win at 9 o'clock. Oklahoma and Oklahoma State. It's available in high definition on ESPN HD. That's Big Monday.
I can't get over to see Rick Pitino on Monday night. Rick's had a lot of injuries this year. Palacios is back now, but he lost so many quality players. McGee's out and Jenkins has been out. Paget earlier this year. They've won 8 of their last 10, one on the road today against DePaul.
Lawson with a miss, but Hansborough tipped it outside in the new 35 for Carolina. Hansborough blocked.
He's going to go to the free throw line.
Checking with Aaron Andrews. Aaron, what do you have?
Mike, just to add on what you and Dick have been talking about with this team being so unselfish and, you know, sharing the ball. These freshmen, Brandon Wright told me, spent a lot of time together in the offseason. Actually, four of them live together, just like Dickie V knows this. The Florida Gators freshmen live together. And Brandon Wright told me he feels like they're very mature for their age. And the fact that they all lived in the same suite has helped them gel on the court so much.
I knew one thing. I knew we had to hear the Florida Gators here tonight. Aaron is still on.
Why not? They've had a pretty good year, Dick.
What a program. Football and basketball. In fact, that combination might be the best duo in America as a duo now. Donovan and Urban Meyer.
Aaron's been smiling all year long. She's always happy.
She's a true Gator. But she's making a lot of cash. And the president there told me she hasn't made a donation yet. I'm only teaching you, Aaron.
Dick, why don't you just pick out the schools that we went to? You make all the donations. Oh. We'll all be in good shape.
I got no cash, Mike. I'm just a frivolous guy. Butch Davis in the house tonight.
New North Carolina football coach. 7:14 to go on this one. The lead is 19.
It's all started with that defensive effort by North Carolina. Right out of the gate. Really came out, played defense.
Britton guarded by Lawson. Morrow finally gets a good look and can't hit it. Lawson pushes it. Hansborough got caught underneath. Good defense by Dickey, and then Morrill came over and helped.
He's such a great college player, Hansbrough, because he plays with such passion.
Right there, right there.
It's a miss by Young. It's going to be an intentional foul underneath. Let's see who picks this one up. It's going to be Dickey. And he and Hansbrough separated by the officials.
Teddy Valentine talking to him now. Gonna watch the jump shot. A Young.
Oh, I see why.
Sir. Yes, sir. Right there. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The referee's got it right there with the elbow.
So Hansbrough will go to the line. That's an intentional foul on Dickey. We've had two intentional fouls called on Georgia Tech tonight. And the official's doing a good job trying to break it up in a hurry.
It wasn't flagrant. He was really trying to get position, and he had a high elbow in his court for it.
It's a really good crew with Ted Valentine, Les Jones, and Ray Natilli.
Teddy Valentine, he gets more air time than Jay Leno. I mean, the guy's on all the time. Every time you turn on a two.
Not than you, though. You're on more than Leno.
Let me tell you this, Lawson really playing under control. That was the big question mark. Could they get him to control his speed?
And they have. Terry, baseline.
Layup.
Exploded.
How many layups have we seen tonight?
Too many if you're Georgia Tech.
Too many is right.
16 for Terry.
Biggest loss this year was to UCLA out of the Maui. Well, you had told me he really loves that UCLA team because of their defensive ability.
Crittenden lost it on the way, and look at the speed of Lawson. Lawson is fouled by Peacock. Peacock going for the ball, so that is not intentional. That'll be three on Peacock.
I think when you talk up on top, you look at UCLA, as you're going to see this come back the other way, the ball go to Lawson ahead of the pack, and then you're going to see the contact. There it is. But you know,
isn't like the UCLA loss, Dick. They're getting thumped tonight.
Exactly. But UCLA does it defensively. They really come after you. Florida's a good offensive team. They've got the best front court in America. As you look at Paul Hewitt saying, not to be honest. I'll tell you one thing I love about Paul. Always very poised, under control.
Class act.
Oh, he's a classy guy in every way possible. It's a great asset to Georgia Tech, represents them in class. I mean, they're going to be in the big dance this year.
Oh, sure. That one wedges up against the rim and the backboard. The possession arrow will give it to Georgia Tech. But the score has grown to 68-44, and Georgia Tech really racking up the fouls in the second half. That's because they're trying to play defense, trying to get steals from North Carolina, and unable to do it.
It's going to be very tough to try to trap North Carolina. That score can blow up big time. They're getting a thump in here tonight by one of the premier teams in America. I think the best.
Baseline jumper in and out. Not too many offensive rebounds either.
Well, they have a margin of 11.4 on the boards. North Carolina, an outstanding rebounding team.
Ellington, who hasn't been much of an offensive factor tonight, with a miss there. Crittenden trying to blow down the lane and shows you the quickness he has. But Crittenden only has 7 points tonight. Young man who averages 14 points and almost 6 assists a game.
Yeah, they've really done a great job containing them. You know, rebound margin, North Carolina's number one in the nation at 11.4.
But Georgia Tech number two to them in the ACC. And Green open for three, and he buries it.
They really love finding the open man. When you look at this club, there's three major factors. They have balance offensively, inside and outside. They share the basketball, and now they're defending. And if you do all three, that's a formula for winning.
All right, we're going to ask you about your top fans, Dick. The total experience of being a fan, especially during Student Spirit Week, you've got Duke, Cameron Indoor.
There's a Dukies there. Oklahoma State's got some great fans. You got to like them down here. Kentucky, Pittsburgh, the Oakland Sioux had a chance to be with them. Rock Chalk, Jayhawk, the Rowdy Reptiles down in Florida. I saw Aaron Andrews there. North Carolina, where they got such a passion. So much spirit. Spirit Week. It's been unbelievable. And great being with you, buddy.
My pleasure.
Great being with you 20 years now.
At least.
Oh, you kept all your hair. Mine's all gone.
Well, yours was almost gone when I met you.
Yeah, I've always been gone since I was 22 years old. First time I looked at my team, I looked, I said, how am I going to win? My guards look like Mike Patrick. How am I going to win?
With that, no way. And North Carolina had just shown you just about everything they have tonight. This team is so deep, so athletic, and so unselfish, and has all the skill sets that you need to be an outstanding ball club. And as they develop throughout the rest of the year, people are going to get lumped like this an awful lot. Good teams.
One area of concern has always been their defensive effort. Tonight has been there.
Well, we saw it against Clemson as well. They were outstanding.
And we saw it in the last 4 minutes against Virginia Tech.
Yes. Virginia Tech built a big lead. Carolina came storming back. That's the problem with young teams, though. They didn't come out and play against Tech with the kind of intensity that they wanted. Dick, that'd look good on you, wouldn't it?
Oh, I tell you what, not bad. I like that. I love that Carolina blue, that color as well. I tell you, the students, that's 1,400 on the SATs. Took me three times, 500, 500, and 400.
Just shows you were persistent.
Hey, Mike, if you had a discussion right now, ACC Player of the Year, you can think about Hansbrough. I think you got to think about Jared Dudley of Boston College, maybe a Josh McRoberts, maybe an Al Thornton. Sean Singletary's been brilliant. Who comes to your mind?
Dudley and Hansbrough.
Yeah,
and I think Dudley's going to be hurt because Sean Williams was dismissed from the team.
Great
and
point.
He is such a tremendous player. I feel really bad for him.
You know, coming into this game, if you asked me, coming into this game, who would be the diaper dandy in the conference? I would have said Crittenden because of the value of what he's meant to that team. Where you look at Brandon Wright, he's got so much help with Hansbrough and company. But after tonight, it might change a little bit.
Well, I mean, you've got to look at Lawson.
Yes, Lawson will be
you know, a guy who has been such an outstanding point guard so far.
This kid also, Spears down at Boston College. You can think about Shire and Duke, but I think really it'll come down to Crittenden and Wright.
Crittenden on the double team. Almost threw it away. Young, good crossover to get to the baseline, goes with the reverse. We have seen Thaddeus Young show some of his stuff tonight, 15 points.
Well, they wanted him badly at North Carolina, and you can see why. So athletic, explosive, plays on that wing. Georgia Tech people have to just hang in. They're going to have a good year. They're going to win their games at home.
Three-pointer from Young.
He's big time. They just have to learn. They need that one breakthrough win on the road to get back mentally. Because I believe, like Jay Billis and I were talking, we think it affects you. You start to believe you can't win away from
sure.
home.
Sure. Well, Young was the fifth or sixth best recruit in the country. The block inside. Green got it back, and Green stepped on the baseline. Roy Williams knows. If this team plays defense the way he wants them to, they're going to be very, very tough. And Paul Hewitt saw it tonight. Carolina in control in Chapel Hill, 73-53. Hope you watched game day earlier today. You got to see something really fun. Alex Bloom, a business major from Arkansas, hit that half-court shot. It was in all the way.
Wow.
Hit the State Farm wow. half-court shot. The school got 10 grand wow. for the general scholarship fund. Alex Bloom got the other three for himself. Congratulations,
hey, wow.
Alex Bloom.
Diaper dandy. He's got to go down to Franklin Street, and that $3,000 is going to cost him $5 because he's going to treat the whole freshman class.
Well, if they had another scholarship, he might have gotten it.
I had a big smile on the face of Mr. Schwab. Stumped the Schwab. Mr. Popularity here with a lot of the students.
Howie did a great job, didn't he?
Oh, yeah.
I don't think anybody stumped him. They tried to draw a charge on Lawson. This is Guignard back into the ballgame. Lawson left all alone. He'll try it from outside. Under 3 minutes to go.
It's been all North Carolina right out of the gate. It's been wire to wire.
Left Crittenden alone. He misses. Young can't get the rebound. Lawson ahead to Wright. Excellent defense by Georgia Tech. Look at the pass ahead to Young from Smith.
Big time.
What a pass.
There's the windmill dug. Georgia Tech's going to put a hurt on a lot of teams. They're athletic.
I mean, Smith, that play, he saves the ball, goes up in the air, and makes a perfect three-quarter court pass.
I love Thaddeus Young. I tell you what, he's better than advertised.
He has 20 tonight.
And he's got to go for a root canal. The guy's got to go for a root canal.
They had a mess with the rest of his team.
I remember once having a root canal by the Georgia Tech dentist. I was down on a campus there to do a game, Georgia Tech and Duke, and I was in trouble. And he did a root canal job, and I was back at work.
Here's Alex Bloom enjoying the ball game after a great day for him. I bet there are a lot of people around the country that would like to see you with a lot of dental implements in your mouth, wouldn't they?
I think a lot of people would have liked to have been in that dentist's shoes while I was sitting in that chair.
Mr. Vitale, I've got the drill. What would you like? Let me drill for oil. I feel lucky.
Hey, let's talk a little football tomorrow. I know you're a football guy. I got Peyton Wright and company beating Tom Brady. Tom, don't hear me tonight, but I think it's going to belong to Peyton Manning. And I'm going to tell you, I think Manning's moving on. Tony Dungy and Lovie Smith. I think Chicago too much at home in Chicago, setting up Dungy and Lovie Smith. And Peyton Manning's going to win the Super Bowl.
Up next on ESPN SportsCenter, Scott Van Pelt, Neil Everett. The stories are Saturday Top 25 action. The Steelers, have they hired the right man to replace Bill Cowher? Only time will tell on that one. And has Peyton Manning solved Belichick? I don't think anybody has solved Bill Belichick. I still think he is the only certifiable genius in that league, but I think Peyton Manning is the best quarterback in football.
What's he going for, his fourth out of 5 years?
Yeah, it's just unbelievable. He'll have his own statue one of these days.
Hey, right, 7 for 9, field goals tonight. He's 65% from the field.
1:23 to go in this one, and Carolina has just dominated Georgia Tech from the get-go.
They got a big date on the weekend. They're going to play Arizona at Arizona. That's going to be an angry team. Arizona wants a lot of respect. They always feel that there's a mentality that's always pushing the East, and you know they're going to be ready to play. They're a talented team despite losing 3 in a row. Look at Lawson.
Lawson was tripped as he went between the double team, got his balance back, and put it in anyway.
He's so much better now than he was earlier in the year. Looks like
Smith, triple teamed and fouled.
Well, 1,900 wins in the book for this University of North Carolina basketball, second to the Kentucky Wildcats at 1941. Put 1,900 in the book.
This will be Georgia Tech's 11th loss in a row on this court and their 15th straight loss on an opponent's home court. That'll change.
Dr. Patrick, do you think that affects them psychologically?
I think it does, Dick, but, you know, they'll go play 5 or 6 teams this year where I think they'll get rid of that, don't
they? Yeah, I think they're better than a lot of the bottom clubs in the ACC.
Big hand for the starters and a couple of the reserves as they come out. And Roy Williams clears his bench. 24-31 with 49.3 on the clock.
You know, currently at 509 wins. He's in his 19th season, 18 years. He's made the NCAA, 17 of those 18. Will be 18 out of 19 this year. He's had 6 seasons with 30 or more wins. In the national championship, 2005.
Miller guarded by West, the best on the ball defender there is, I think, in the ACC. And Miller will commit the foul.
Scoring really a dilemma tonight for Georgia Tech. Really ran into a buzzsaw defensively out of North Carolina.
West very slow to get up, holding that left shoulder. There's the 1,900 win. Georgia Tech must have felt like they got all of them tonight.
Atlanta will be the host of the Final Four this year. They do a great job down here. I love going to Atlanta. It's a great city. I almost bought a home one time down in Dunedin, which is right in the suburbs. came very close, but then decided to head a little bit more south and went to Florida.
Well, we'll be down in your area for the ACC tournament. We have it in Tampa this year.
We're having a big party on Wednesday night. ESPN, big ACC party at my home. And I got a Freddie Barracat.
Have I missed my invitation in the mail yet?
You'll be there, that's for sure. It's going to be a great night Wednesday night. ESPN's hosting it. Going to honor Fred in his last year. He's done a phenomenal job in the conference.
That he has.
Georgia Tech's season low was 64. That was the Vanderbilt and Kevin Stallings who beat Kentucky tonight. Ends an 11-game win streak at Kentucky.
Big, big win for North Carolina tonight as Morrow, who didn't get enough opportunities tonight to help his team as much as he would like to, hits the final bucket of the game, and North Carolina will win by 16.
Too much defense tonight, Mike. They played so well defensively, and they shared the basketball so well.
Once again, the final score tonight, fourth-ranked North Carolina wins at 77-61. Next on ESPN SportsCenter. For more on this game, we'll be on ESPN News in just a few moments to wrap things up. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Dick Vitale and Aaron Andrews and our entire ESPN crew, this is Mike Patrick. Good night from Chapel Hill. Thanks for watching. Here is SportsCenter.